Ripley's in space after sucking off an alien. Burke aptly named, says she's got to get back here, and they fuck her off to a planet to advance the plot. Hudson is a coward, Vasquez is well hard, she has no tits and she wears a bandana. I'm fairly sure that she is packing a cock. Hicks is dreamy, Burke's just seedy, the rest of them are Star Trek away teamy, and Spuckmeyer's name means he's bound to shoot his load. They look in the chute and they find a girl called Newt. She'd be quite annoying, but she's also quite cute. She's managed to survive, so she tells them all how it goes. They mostly come out at night. Mostly. Drax start beeping, Hudson's nappy starts leaking. Overhead air vents start squeaking. There's disco strobes and a testosterone overload. Oh, let's rock. Game over, man. Game over. Back into space with the alien queen, and she makes Bishop look like he's gargling semen. Splits him in two with a tail right through his chest. The machine is cool, but I feel I must warn you, she looks like Gozer the Gozerian's transformer. Ripley's ass looks better in pants and vest. Newt and Hicks, beloved by the people, get killed off by the start of the next sequel. The only way this film could be better is to have the theme tune to Raiders of the Lost Ark. And thank you.
And thank you very much to Brad there. Yes, that was Brad Thornton doing our intro there from way back in the mists of time. We used it again because hello and welcome everybody to Aliens episode, or rather Black Dog episode 282. I'm Lee.
I'm Darren.
I'm Jim.
I'm Elton.
And we're also joined by Herc.
Hello, everybody.
There you go. Lovely. There you go. A man in Canada. Cool. It's like it's almost like I haven't done these intros in like 2 weeks. It's amazing. Anyway. Oh, well. Anyway, yeah. So thank you again to Brad for letting us have that intro again, because that was brilliant. And yes, here we are. Episode 282, The Black Dog. Yay.
Hurrah.
Hurrah.
Yay.
Swish.
Still not at 300.
No.
No, sorry. Anyway. Anyway, so yeah, so we're going to have a bit of chat. We're going to have a shitty superhero, a Profanosaurus.
Yes, indeedy.
And then we're going to get on with this week's movie, which was actually supposed to be last week's movie, but things happened and shit stuff and whatever. And yeah, it's Aliens, 30th anniversary of one of the greatest sequels of all time. But let's not... Keep the powder dry. Keep the powder dry. Anyway, so let's get going. So we're going to see how everyone's week's been. And we'll start with our guest, Mr. Herc. How's your week been?
I'll tell you only the good stuff, so it'll be nice and short. We had Montreal Jazz Festival for the past 2 weeks, which has been really, really cool. So I saw Sharon Jones and the Dap Kings. I don't know if you've heard of them or...
Nope.
So I think she's most famous. She did a cover, like a really amazing cover of Just Dropped In, the song that's, yeah, you know, famous for being in the dream sequence in Big Lebowski.
Yeah.
And yeah, I went to see her because she has... So she had cancer and then she went into chemo and kind of fought it back, but now it's back. So I thought, well, that's about that. Yep. Probably going to be the only chance I get to see her. And I was kind of worried that it could have been kind of like Maudlin, and like every song would be, oh, this, you know, this means something to me, and then everything kind of gets sad and sentimental.
Mm-hmm.
But instead, mm-hmm, it was just like it kind of like she kind of said what the songs now meant to her, but not in a Maudlin way. And then when she sang, like, she's not described as the female James Brown for nothing. She's got an immense voice, and like as the night went on, she kind of like picked up more and more energy. And you could tell like she was getting empowered by the crowd and like feeding that energy back and forth. So that was one of the best shows I've ever seen.
Awesome.
And then because obviously we are seeing the rise in right-wing terrorism and white supremacy and nationalism, I assumed I'd been transported back to the 1930s, so I thought I'll go see some swing music. So I went and saw Big Bad Voodoo Daddy, and they played two sets, and they were fucking amazing, like really high energy. It's like really catchy, all really good musicians. His voice is as good as it like was in the 90s, which is impressive. Mm. And by the second set, I managed like make my way all the way to the front row, and I've recorded like an hour and a half of them, which is really kind of a cool memory to have. So awesome. Yeah, apart from those two concerts, everything else is terrible, so let's move on.
Well, there you go, brilliant. All right, well then we'll move on then. So over to you, Elton.
Okay, last 2 weeks, I had my daughter's play, which mm-hmm. didn't involve spaceships or blowing up or anything like that, so I was very disappointed, which yeah. I pointed out to her. And I was also annoyed by people videoing the concert.
Oh, God.
Sorry, Herc. But it was more the fact that they video it the vertical way, but I think that's something for me to moan about at a later date.
Hold on,
landscape, so I'm fine.
Oh, good.
So hold on, so let me get this straight. Your problem was that it wasn't so much that they were filming it or they were in your way, but the fact they were using the wrong aspect ratio.
It bugged the fuck out of me. Really did. That's all I could see. Right, well, my daughter said she was in this play, and I thought, okay, brilliant. What's it about? Is it about spaceships? And gave all that malarkey. And she was like, no. Asked her how many lines she had. She went, one. Oh, okay. So I'm going to that for one line. Yes, and it's at the beginning. Oh, okay, great. So I'd seen her line. Saw her on stage and everything like that. And
did
then
she play a red shirt?
It wasn't about spaceships.
At all?
No.
Oh.
No. It was very disappointing. But after that, then I started looking around the room and I could see more and more people popping up their phones in the portrait. And it's just, that's going to look shit on your TV. That's going to look shit on your YouTube. And it just bugs the living, ever living shit out of me. It really does, you stupid fucking idiots.
Wow. Not that some weird pervo could be taking video of your daughter, but the fact that they're doing it in wrong aspect ratio, that's
at
the
least
problem.
Do it in the right aspect. You little fuckers.
The world is 16:9. If you're sharing this shit, do it do it in the right aspect.
If you're gonna share it well, you bastards.
Nice.
What else? I had Andy pop up at the weekend to check on the suit that I'm making for him and to record a podcast about the Grand Prix that was on at the weekend.
Mm-hmm.
So he's happy and hunky-dory with what I'm doing at the moment. Before then, I saw Independence Day.
Oh, good. Well, hang on to that because I've seen it as well.
Okay. I won't say anything. I'll let you do your bit.
No, it's okay. It's okay. We can both jump in on it.
Yeah, definitely. And I recorded a Sean Killab with your good self.
Yes, and very geeky and nerdy and weird and wacky that was too. I really enjoyed that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's cool.
I got to fly my freak flag proper.
That's the whole idea of that show, so yes, yeah. Let loose.
But it was very good. I really enjoyed that. So, yes, thank you for letting me on there.
Cool.
Yes.
And that's around about it.
Okay, cool. Okay, well, we'll come back to that bit. And Independence Day, you can definitely wade in on that because I'm sure you've got something to say. I know I have. Anyway, so over to you then, Jim.
I had actually a pleasant little breakaway. Mm-hmm. Went down to Norwich in Norfolk.
Mm-hmm.
And mainly had good weather, amazingly, for the British summertime.
Mm-hmm.
And had some very enjoyable days out. Ate too much, drank too much.
Oh, that's good.
Around the wonderful Norwich Cathedral. and went on a bit of a spending flyer and ended up coming home with a new tablet, which I didn't intend to buy.
What kind of tablet?
It's a Samsung Tab A with the S Pen.
Wow.
I've had my eye on this for a while, and I'd noticed kind of the prices had come down. When I first looked, they were at 270, they'd come to 250. And then I saw Curry's had it down to 220, limited stock. I thought, I'm having one.
Nice.
As they might stop making them. And as my old tab was getting old and shit, and it's kind of getting too slow to do anything with. But this is like smaller, faster. Well, the same size, but thinner, if you see what I mean.
Yeah.
And the S Pen is actually, I've been faffing around with different styluses and drawing apps, and none of them were quite sensitive enough. But the S Pen is just kind of, this is what I wanted.
Nice.
As it's, you know, it's not just a magic bit of plastic. It has got Wacom technology and so with a proper tracker. And it's kind of, yep, that's the responsiveness I've been after, after doing all kinds of fiber tip and rag tip and this tip, that tip, different styluses I've tried over the past few years, and all going, they're all right, but it just doesn't, it's not quite right.
Yeah.
It's always feel like drawing with a glove on.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Well, this is kind of, oh yeah, I can actually do handwriting, and it doesn't look like I've just grabbed a crayon in my fist and gone, look there.
Nice. So will we be seeing some digital art from you pretty soon, sir?
If I can keep off fucking Scribble Racer for 10 minutes, yes, you will. It's a very fun little time-wasting game. You used the S Pen rather brilliantly.
Nice. I'm glad I don't have that. Always, I just lose all my time down a time sink.
You know, it's like those games you used to do with pen and paper. You draw a track. Usually in class.
Yeah.
And then you take it and flick your pencils and just go, it's sort of like that.
Oh, God.
It's a scrolling track, and you just have to, you know, follow it with your pen, and you pick up power ups, and it gets faster and faster and faster. It's all like, look, has that look of a kid's drawing, and it's very fun.
Nice.
I think I'm a grand time. Mr. Al didn't wreck the house.
Yeah.
And I'm also now just not so much a bucket list, but I'm a big believer in fulfilling all those little whims you used to have as a kid and never got round to.
Yeah.
Now, as a kid, I kind of half got this one. Like us all, I wanted a Venus flytrap. I bought one.
Yeah.
Fucker died.
Oh, no.
A few years ago, I bought another one. Fucker died. However, now in this age of the internet, I'm going to give this another go. I'm going to properly research it. I've got a lovely big glass, recycled glass, kind of like an old-fashioned fish bowl.
Yeah.
It's got a proper carnivorous plant compost, because that's where everyone goes wrong. They don't like any old soil. Most soil's too acidic or too alkaline, it'll kill the roots.
Yep.
And what they never tell you on the little tags in the shop is you have to water them with rainwater, because just the chlorine and whatnot in our drinking stuff that comes out the tap will kill them. They're very sensitive.
Okay.
So this time I've got rainwater, proper compost, nice big bowl. I've repotted the little snappy fellow, and fingers crossed, I will have carnivorous plants. And
tell me it's called Audrey 2.
Watch out. It might be hungry.
Tell me it's called Audrey 2.
Audrey 3.
Yeah. Yeah. When it starts singing like Levi Roots, then you get out of the house.
Yep. That's the time to run.
Feed me.
I had one of them a little while ago, and I thought I killed it because I kept putting pencils in it to make it close.
Well, that will kill them as well, yes.
Yeah. You stab it with a fucking 2HB, then it's, you know. you try someone jam one of those down your throat. I mean, see how long you last.
Yeah, exactly. God, dear Elton.
Lead poisoning. There we go.
You're history's greatest monster.
I wasn't drawing inside it. I was tickling the hairs so it closed, and I thought...
Euphemism.
Yeah.
Elton McManus, slayer of carnivorous plants.
I thought it was closing and then not getting any food, and so it was dying because it was hungry.
Well, that's partly it, but it's also it cost the plant a lot of energy to open, not so much close the trap, but to open it up again.
Yeah.
And that depletes it. And
It
also confuses it. It's going, I should be eating, there's nothing there. And it's diverting resources to digest something that isn't.
You're a horrible man. You're a horrible, horrible
why
man.
Why don't you throw dead flies into it or something?
Yeah, there you go.
yeah,
I have a pencil.
Well, at least you weren't feeding it a hamburger, which is apparently what a lot of people try to do. Catch a fly.
Can I just ask, did you ever keep pigeons at all at some point in your life? You know, did you, like, you know, when you fed them, did you sellotape bird crumbs to like a windowsill or something
and just watch them
peck themselves to fucking death? Is that what you did?
I may do that.
Mm, pulls the legs off.
Christ, I'm giving him ideas.
I'm just saying it's not called a Venus pencil trap.
No. Oh, dear. Right, okay, then. Well,
if you could make one of those that sharpen pencils.
Oh,
imagine that.
Yeah, Staples would be the greenest place on earth. Cool. Anything else, Jim?
No, that'll do for me, I think.
Okie dokie, then we'll move on to our man. And I, before we even get going... I'm just, before I even ask him, I've just got to cue it up because
I've got nothing really to moan about this week.
You sure?
Shut the fuck up.
Yeah.
No, I haven't. Even going to the cinema, I've got nothing to complain about at the cinema either.
Okay, yeah. I'm keeping Curb Your Enthusiasm on standby. That's all I'm saying. Go on in.
Just in case, yeah?
Yeah, just in case, because it's going to happen. I don't. See if you can make it through the segment. Go on.
So we'll start off with a very, very small Mel Smith moment of the week. I'm put it on anyway, you fucker. So a couple of weeks ago, when I met your good self,
yes,
down the pub with a couple of others, of course.
Yes.
After we'd finished drinking, Mr. Placides guided me up the road to where my wife was waiting, and as I approached the pub. Who should come out of the pub
but
Craig Revel Hall, judge on Strictly Ballroom.
Yes.
Now, I've had a few to drink, so I spot him, and totally out of character to me, he's like, he's talking to people, and I just walk up to him without a word, and I shove my hand in his face.
What?
Yeah, it's like that, to go to shake his hand.
Oh, right.
And he kind of looks down as if I'm holding a knife at him.
Well, yeah. Okay.
And you could see this in his eyes. And he did shake my hand.
Mm.
And then after I left, I'm down the road with Andy. And it's like, why the fuck did I shake his hand?
Ah, you had a proper moment.
But it's kind of like you could see it in his eyes. He was 2 seconds away from calling up his lawyer and organising a fucking restraining order.
Nice.
Laura's like, no, he was all right. He was fine. I'm like, no, he fucking wasn't. I said, I looked into his very soul. I saw into his eyes. I saw the fear.
Yeah, well, you know, which just makes you more and more like Buffalo Bill every second.
Exactly.
He's like, I saw into his soul.
That's my Strictly Ballroom, or should I say Strictly Come Dancing career, completely over now. You won't find me on there.
Well, surprisingly enough, I wasn't placing bets. But anyway, go on in. So what else was going on then?
Well, let's see. I'll just cut to the chase. Let's get on to what I went and saw last night.
Mm.
Went and saw Ghostbusters at the O2.
Mm.
And spoiler-free review, I liked it.
Yep.
Yes, there are a few problems.
Yep.
Like sometimes the delivery of the humour is... let's see, how can I describe it? You know where you watch... an actor, a comedy actor, and you kind of, after 20 minutes, figure out their sort of like their delivery mode, how they get these jokes across, and you can kind of tell what they're going to do
before they
when
do
certain
it.
Situations come up.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sometimes it got a little bit like that.
Mm.
And plus, there was one actress in it. She's only in it for a couple of scenes, but she's actually, as you're watching... one character do something, she's describing it to you. So you're getting an audio review of what someone's doing right in front of you.
You sure you weren't...
Born for the Blind.
Yeah, exactly.
You sure you weren't in the audio description cinema?
It might have been. I don't know. But, I mean, that is very, very small. That's a very, very small complaint for the rest of the film.
Yeah.
Like I say, genuinely enjoyed it. They've tried to do something a little bit different with it.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, they've tried to give it a little bit more reason why things are happening.
Okay.
And I think it works.
Okay. So are you basically saying... Oh, that's the end of that then. Right. So basically, are you actually saying that, that knee-jerk reactions on the internet may have actually been wrong?
Do you know what? I've not realised this up until this point, but... By Jiminy, I think you've hit the nail on the head, Mr. Medcalf.
Fuck, my mind is blown. I have no... Everything I believed in is wrong.
Exactly. This is it. Ah!
Argh. Well,
this is it now. I don't recognise this world. What, with Brexit coming first and now this? What is this, the fucking apocalypse?
the internet, they did a knee-jerk reaction 24 months ahead of schedule and got it wrong.
Yes, indeed.
Again.
And I just wonder how many of those people, when they do finally go and see it, because, you know, to have an opinion on something, it's got to be informed. Yeah. So when they do finally go and see it, I wonder how many of them will actually admit that they actually sat there and enjoyed it?
None of them. Absolutely.
Almost none.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. You might as well sort of wish for a unicorn than ask for someone to suddenly change their mind. Especially if they've been so vociferous online. What you got to do is you got to wait like a good 2-3 years for something else to come along, and then watch the shift. Watch the Phantom Menace moment happen when everyone suddenly does the Force Awakens to Phantom Menace. Phantom Menace isn't so bad thing. You wait for that to happen.
Oh, that'll happen.
Yeah.
Yes.
You know, just wait for everyone to go, well, I never said it. It wasn't me who said it.
Oh man, I hope there isn't a spate of Ghostbusters 2 is actually better than the original.
Well, that's the next thing, isn't it?
No. Yeah. I don't think if you like the original, you're still going to really like the original. You'll probably still like it more than this one. But
you mean the reason for this film doesn't mean people come round your house and take away your old DVDs and erase your mind, Men in Black style?
No,
this is a revelation to me.
I know it's a night of firsts. I don't understand this.
Every day's a school day, man. Every day's a school day. Always learning, always moving target harder to hit.
Like a shark, you never stop still. Otherwise, you'll die. Yeah.
That's it. Never sleep. Keep going. Keep moving.
Always going. Always moving.
Always one step ahead of the enemy. Yep.
Yep. There you go.
So I would highly recommend it. And yes, there is an after credit sequence, which I do recommend people stay and watch.
Okay.
And that's it.
Question, is that mid credits or after credits?
It's after credits. There is stuff going on during the credits, up to about, 2 or 3 minutes into the credits, there's stuff that you'll see. That's it. Yeah, running through it, there's bits and bobs that will kind of keep you entertained.
Is it basically Paul Feig at the very end sticking two fingers up going...
Yeah, basically. Yeah, he goes, he's like, you know, admit it, you fucking loved it.
Yeah. I'll be outside.
I'll
be out. Fuck the lot of you. I can take the lot of you on.
Yeah. I'll be outside counting the money that you said you weren't going to give me. Yeah.
So while not perfect, it still doesn't deserve the crucifixion it received before, you know, from these people who suddenly gained the powers of Mystic Meg and were able to see this film, apparently, before it's even had been made.
Well, they did. That's exactly it. They got the powers of Mystic Meg, and she hasn't been able to predict anything. She can't even predict whether or not she's going to get up in the morning. So,
if you see it and you still genuinely hate it, then that's fine.
You know. I'm seeing it on Saturday, so I don't know yet.
Yeah, well, I'm seeing it again on Saturday because I went by myself, but I'm taking Laura to see it. So I think it's that whole thing of will it stand up on a second showing? I think my mind will be totally made up by then as to whether I really enjoyed it.
Cool. Excellent. Anything else, sir?
No, really.
Okay. Well, I've got quite a list. Not all of it's super duper interesting, but I'll go through it as I wrote it down. This is a bit like Harmontown. I have my Evernote with it on. This week I played a game called Inside, which is a game not for the faint-hearted and is very short, but fuck my old boots. Do you want to go and just go and hug yourself and cry in a corner by the end of it? It's just the grimmest thing I've ever played.
I've seen the previews of it. I mean, been watching the trailer on Xbox Live and stuff, and it looks stunning.
It is beautiful. It is a beautiful game. For those who don't know about it, it's a game that was made by a company that made another walkie platformer called Limbo.
Yeah, I enjoyed that.
And essentially, it's the same sort of idea. You're a young boy who's kind of running through a forest. You have no idea why. And slowly but surely, he's only got like two abilities. One to jump, one to pull things. That's it. That's all you can do. Pull, jump, and that's it. And without a word of dialogue, this game manages to tell you the entire story of this kid and what's going on, and sort of slowly ease you into this very disturbing world that you find the kid in. And by the end of it, you're like, what the fuck have I just seen? What am I looking at? Oh my God. And it lingers with you afterwards for a very long time. you feel slightly sullied. That's all I can say. It's an impressive little psychological trick that this game plays on you. It's like a Walking J horror movie mixed with David Cronenberg, mixed with I don't know what. It's just very weird. And yeah, if you're into looking at beautiful images and fantastic animation and elegantly done puzzles, then this is a game for you. But it is a little expensive for a 3-hour play. I mean, it's £15, and you play for... I think you can finish the game in about... I finished it in about 3.5 hours.
Wow.
But
this is on the Xbox, right?
It's on the Xbox, and I think it's coming soon to the PlayStation, and then it'll be out on... And it's definitely out on PC as well.
Cool.
It is worth a look. I mean, just try and go in as plain as you can. You know, cool. You'll get some really basic sort of puzzles to start with. And then by about midway through, things start to get weird. And then by the time you get to the end, you're like, yeah. That's all I can say. Anyway, I'll leave that there. The next thing, I saw Independence Day Regurgitation. which is quite possibly the stupidest thing I've watched all year. What did you think of it, Owen? Because
I thought
it was bollocks.
I was so bored in the cinema.
Yeah.
I was so bored. I wasn't disappointed because it was exactly how I thought it would be. It was utter tripe.
Yeah, I agree. It was complete shit. It's one of these films where every line of dialogue is so utterly predictable that you literally are saying the next line before any character says it. Here, I'll tell you what. Just who hasn't seen it yet?
Me,
I've not.
Right, okay.
Oh, have I?
I haven't either. But
right, okay. I've seen the first one. I think we all have seen it.
Yes, exactly. Well, I tell you what. Here's a quiz for you. All right, I'm going to read you the first line, and you see if you can come up with the second line. Okay. Now, I'll just describe the scene. There's the president, he's flying a spaceship. Then the next spaceship comes alongside him, right? Yeah. Next spaceship comes alongside him, and it's his daughter, and they're looking across from cockpit to cockpit. And she says to him, "Dad, you don't have to do this. You don't have to save the world again." He turns around and he says, and here's where you've got to jump in. He turns around and he says, "I wasn't saving the world. I was
saving you."
Correct. Yeah. Well done. There you go. And all the dialogue is like that. Every single line. But it's so clunky. The dialogue is almost sort of written on slabs of granite. It's that clunky. It's just all the special effects are terrible. They are genuinely fucking awful. There was a thing on Sky which was a thing about Eurovision sports ball or whatever it fucking was, and basically they had Jeff Goldblum in his Independence Day flight suit, standing against what looked like a very obvious green screen, reading out lines of dialogue about pilots, and it was some monkey man who earns too much money, and then another monkey man who earns too much money, and another monkey man who earns too much money, and they've all got like a line of dialogue which is holding a football under their arm. And I looked at that and I thought, well, that looks cheap and shit, because that's cheap and shit, and it's literally done on the fly in the last minute, and Jeff Goldblum just happens to be doing like a, I don't know, press thing. So we've just got him, stuck him in a flight suit, and stuck him in front of a green screen for 10 minutes and gave him a grand. Then I realised that what they had done was not got Jeff Goldblum, but they'd actually cut a scene from the film and just put Monkey Man 1, 2 and 3 with T-shirts on and stuck them in. And it was like, what? So the shit special effects weren't Sky, that was the film. And all the sets were green screen, and all the sets were obviously green screen. And I just, and then on top of that, they make these leaps of logic, and I'm going to spoil it. So if anyone doesn't want to hear this next bit, just leap forward 5 minutes. And if you don't want to hear it, any of you guys who are the hosts, just tell me now. But frankly, the big spaceship comes along. Now, this spaceship's so fucking big that it literally shaves the top of the moon off. Right? It literally shaves the top of the moon off.
Cheese, right? Gromit. It's made of cheese.
It does. It literally. And it goes along, and it comes along, and it lands on the Earth, right, in a way that's so big that it needs gravity assist to slow it down. So it sucks up half of Korea and Singapore and Dubai, and then sort of goes around in a sort of weird L shape on the map, and then lands over London and drops the whole lot back on London, right? But after about 2 minutes, you get to the Americans, who obviously haven't been landed on because, hey, it's America. And what happens is they put a heat signature, they put a heat radiation thing up there, and they look at it and they go, see all these thousands of little dots? Those are the aliens. What's that big dot right in the middle? And they go, well, obviously that's the Queen. And you go,
oh,
what? How did you suddenly come to that conclusion, given that you're pointing your heat thermodynamic bollocksy thing at the big fucking gun? It's like, couldn't that be the power source? Couldn't that be the gun? Couldn't that be, I don't know, Obly Job 4000? What could it be? It could be anything. It could be the fucking heat reclaimant. It could be an air conditioning unit. It could be fucking anything. Oh no,
that's maybe one of them had watched the Alien special edition earlier in the day.
Yeah, exactly. And it just went, oh, that must be the Queen. This thing's the fucking size of a small fucking, I don't know, just like it's like the size of an aircraft carrier. And they went, oh yeah, that's definitely the Queen. And it's like, how the fuck did you know that?
It looks Queeny, didn't it?
They could be growing cannabis up there.
That could be their fucking sun lamps. It could be anything. Anyway, sure enough, it is a Queen, and the thing's the size of a fucking aircraft carrier. And it's just stupid film. And
that the Queen that you're on about, the shots that it had when it was, oh, see, I don't want to ruin it.
Oh fuck it, just do it.
Why not?
Okay. Do you guys mind?
Care. No,
okay.
Go for
no,
it.
No, go on. Just say.
Okay. Give them monkeys.
When it's running around in the desert,
like a rogue camel.
But that's probably the best. He did look like a rogue camel.
He was kind of galloping, wasn't it?
Looking for his own oasis. It looked quite good when it was running. I'll give it that. But it feels like someone had an idea of the alien running around, and they went, well, we need this scene, so let's build the whole scene, whole film around this scene. Mm. And nothing else really joins up very well. It's like someone's got four different puzzles and trying to put them all together. It just doesn't work. Mm. And in the end, they're just like, oh, sod it. No, look, it's fitting. It's fucking fitting. Yes, I know it's like a bubbly bit on the edge, but look, it's, look, there we go, it's in. It's in.
Yeah.
And but it does, the only thing it does do well is it makes the first one look quite good. Yes. I'm not a fan of the first one, but it makes the first one look quite good.
It does. It makes the first one look like fucking Star Wars. I mean, it really is.
Oh, nice. I spoke to Andy at the weekend about this.
Yeah.
And I said to him, right, the analogy is, you know, Jim Carrey in Ace Ventura?
Yeah.
Number 2.
Yeah.
You know when he gets shot in the arms with the darts and his arms go numb?
Yeah, he's flopping about, yeah.
Right. Jim Carrey is the film industry.
Mm.
His arms are the Independence Day films.
One made his arm go numb and the other one's got his legs.
Yeah. That's the only thing I can think of for it.
Yeah, well, I thought it was summed up perfectly by the fact that there was a long lingering shot of Brent Spiner's arse in string pants for a good 2.5 minutes.
Oh, he's the robot hours.
Star Trek. Yeah. Yeah, and he just kind of strolls around in a sort of, a gown, doesn't he, for like half the film. And then basically, you keep staring at his ass and you keep thinking, why are they doing this? And then finally, about 10 minutes before the end, it's suddenly revealed he's gay. And it's like, okay, and this has what bearing on what in the film? Oh, is this why you've been showing us his ass? What the fuck is that about? And then they have this...
How the fuck has he got an ass when all of his muscles would have wasted away?
Oh, he's been in the coma 30 years as well. Yeah, that's... Don't ask me. I mean, stupid, stupid fucking film. I mean, let alone the fact that there's an alien spaceship boring a hole into the centre of the Earth with a mile-wide beam, and it's drilling its way in the sea. And basically, there's one boat that's keeping an eye on them. And it's like about 20 feet away from this big beam. And it's not like falling down the hole or following the water down the hole. There's like 5 blokes getting pissed up on a boat going, "Whoa, they're going to give us $10 million to look at this spaceship." And it's like, what? What are we going back to you? And then right at the very end, they come along and then they suddenly go, oh, right, actually, the bad guys have been defeated, way, whatever. And then they say, but here's a big plot drop, but it's ready for Independence Day 3. And it's like, what? And the film just ends. And it's like, oh, you're expecting us to come back for this?
At that point, I stood up and left my family in the cinema.
Funny enough.
I honestly did.
Funny enough.
I'd had enough.
Drove away. Disgust.
Funny enough, that's exactly what Andy did.
He hasn't spoken to them since.
Yeah. They're still there as far as he knows. But that's what Andy did. As soon as they did that, the credits came down. Andy just got up and fucked off out of the cinema. Pete was still fuming over the fact that he'd seen a Star Trek trailer, and not only a Star Trek trailer, but a Star Trek trailer and a Rihanna video. Which is promoting Star Trek, which was at the beginning, which was the most notable thing for him. And I'm just sitting there going, I would have rather seen the film that they're advertising next. It's just, I don't want to see this. This was just shit. And then what's even funnier is we came out of the cinema, and there was this other guy who came out the cinema with us, and he started laughing. And I'm standing looking at Pete going, that was the stupidest fucking thing I've ever seen. And this bloke behind us, he suddenly piped up and he went, I actually thought it was quite good. And we're like, no, it takes all sorts. All of a sudden, his daughter, who must have been about 10 or 11, came out and she went, that's rubbish.
It's fucking shit.
Yeah, she went, that was rubbish. Can we go? And it was like, there you go. There you go. Out of the mouths of babes. What else? What else in my week? Well, I went rock climbing. That went well.
You survived.
Well, yeah. Fuck my old boots. Without any training whatsoever, I suddenly got put in a harness, attached to a cable, and then basically told that my 8-year-old daughter was going to do the belay. The belay is basically where they hold the rope and basically pull on the rope as you climb up to hold the slack so that if you fall, basically it will hold you. And it's like, right, she's not going to be able to hold my weight. And they're like, oh, no, we've attached her to a sandbag. It's like, what? I'm attached to a sandbag and my daughter? All I can see now is me falling off this thing, my daughter and a sandbag going up in the air, and me being crushed by the pair of them when they fall off the rope. the first time I climbed, I got about 4 feet off the ground and I freaked. And then I thought, well, no, come on, let's try again. Went up the second time, I got like 6 feet up and then I freaked and came back down. And then the third time they said, oh, well, they took me round and this bloke took the teacher who was teaching us, took me around the other side. And there was a wall for 8-year-olds, which was basically a slope, a very steep slope, but a slope nonetheless, instead of a straight wall. And I went up that and I went right to the very top, got to the top. And then my brain, my lizard brain kicked in and my knuckles just went clump. And I'm like, I'm not getting down from here. I'm staying here. I'm safe. I'm holding still. And there's everyone at the bottom going, come down, come down. I'm like, I can't. And they're like, no, come down. Just step down. I can't. And there's Carol going, Carol's up there with me. She's like, let me just take a photograph of you. Click. And I'm like, fucking got me down. I can't get down. Literally, I was frozen. Absolutely frozen. I could not move. Anyway, eventually, what happened? The bloke went, you're on the belay. I've got you now. And I'm like, I can't move. And you know what he did? He just basically yanked on the rope. I went up like a foot, lost me grip on everything, and he just let me down. It's like, it was the only way he could get me down. And I'm like, and I got to the bottom, and like all my hands are shaking. There's tears in my eyes, and I'm like, oh, and then on top of that, they said, oh, right, well, it's your turn to do the belay now. And I'm like, oh, give me a second. And they finally calmed down. They stuck Carol on the belay. She went up on this thing, and I'm like holding the rope. And then she said, I'm coming down. And she did one of these like SAS kind of abseil drops things. And the bloke's like holding on to me, and he's saying, all you got to do is just hold on to this gear and let her down. And I let her down. What I don't tell you is that the harness that's on you is attached to the gear that's holding Carol up in the air. So as soon as I started to let her down, all of her weight on that rope was suddenly pulling the harness up through my bollocks, up around me fucking ears. And I'm like, she's going, let me down faster. And every time I let her down, it's like going, jog, all me bollocks, jog, all me bollocks, jog, all me bollocks, jog, all me bollocks. By the end of it, I had one testicle in my left pocket and the other testicle in my right pocket, because that was the only safe place for them to go, where the harness had shunted like my entire body mass up from my knees.
And I'd just like to remind all listeners that this is legal in England and having a spliff isn't.
I was going to say, do you think now that the British government has, you know, made a deal at the crossroads, that this is like some weird karmic retribution for that photo you took of Boris Johnson?
Yeah, actually, I think that may be the case. I think so. Maybe it's him. Maybe it's the spirit of Boris Johnson coming to get me. Yeah.
We all definitely need to go on the cable car that goes over the Thames.
No, we don't. We do not.
Oh, yes, we do.
No, we don't. You can. I'm not. There's no fucking way.
Yeah, Elton, this is the Blackdog. Haven't you seen Final Destination?
Exactly. Haven't you seen the end of Thunderbirds? I mean, for fuck's sake. Jesus.
I've been on that cable car.
What, the one in Thunderbirds?
No, ooh, yeah, that one as well. But the one going over the Thames. You mean the one in Woolwich?
Yeah,
that
one goes over Greenwich North.
I took Laura on that for a birthday. 1 year, we sort of like, you know, went over the river in it. Thought, this would make a nice change. Yeah, you'd never go up there when there's high winds.
No.
That's all I'll say. You know? Rock back and forth like a bloody swing.
Yeah, well, like I say, I went on that bloody cable car up the side of the volcano in Tenerife. That was bad enough. That was enough for me. I got to the top of that 2-kilometer thing and I was just like, I am never doing that again. Right, okay. I mean, the only other thing, I've got one other thing here, which I thought was, I think I wrote right at the beginning when I literally had nothing written down for a week. But that's since changed. I took the world's stinkiest shit.
Out for a walk? Or?
Well, actually, no. What it was, I went to the loo at work. Yeah. I went to the loo at work. And basically, the girls have been making, like, cakes, like, you know, sort of for some sort of competition at school. And so basically Lisa's been putting all these different colours into the cakes, and one, they're like super strong colours. Anyway, one of them obviously didn't agree with me, and I went to
I went to
the toilet. And next, well, apart from the fact that I'd literally turned the entire bowl green, proper coloured dark, literally Robin of Sherwood green. Apart from that, it was so bad, the smell was so bad, that I literally found myself trapped in the toilet for like a good 25 minutes. Because basically, every time I went to open the door, I could hear someone walking down towards all the traps. And I just thought, I can't walk out and have someone walk in behind me, you know, into that room. I can't do it. So I literally found myself trying to do work and answer emails from my phone in the toilet until the smell cleared. And basically there was this little automated sort of puffer thing, puffing out color, smell, going, but that was just making it worse. It was, it was just like, it was shit, but it was shit with flowers on top now. And it was just like, I just thought, if I walk out of this toilet, all that's going to happen is the smell is just going to hang here for another hour. Everyone's going to know it's me. And like, and then come to the toilet and the toilet is still like stained green, you know, because I couldn't get, just everything was green, like real vivid green. So
I bet that automatic perfume thing was working like a fucking iron lung.
I was going to say, it was... It basically earned its money that day. It really did. And so, yeah, so that was the only other thing I had. And literally, I had a conversation with Foxy, who was sending me texts on WhatsApp while I was there. And hold on, I'll see if I can get these up, because I don't know if this is, I've got this WhatsApp. Just because it was like literally so bad, I was just, I had nothing, I couldn't leave. I couldn't leave. Hold on, let's get past this. Hold on. Oh, here we go. Here we go. right, I'll just read this. Blah 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 blah. News. This is it now. See, I've lost communication with the network, so I can't do emails anymore. And then he sent me a message, and I just said, in other news, I've done a shit that smells so bad, I'm actually staying in the toilet until everyone leaves the area, so I can slip out unnoticed. He went, haha, been there. 10 minutes later, I've gone, I'm still here. The cubicle air freshener has kicked in and it's just made things worse. I'm having trouble breathing. He replies, it's a lockdown, code brown. That's confirmed, code brown. 15 minutes later, I think my only option now is to somehow MacGyver some flammable chemicals up and set off a fire alarm so I can clear the building. He replies, you're not actually joking about this, are you? And then, now at 11:04, just at the moment, no. I'm trying to Google Jay's Fluid Harpic Explosive. And I think it's safe now. I'm going to try and escape. Wish me luck. That was at 11:25. I've been in there for 35 minutes at this point. And he goes, fucking hell, have you been there all this time? And I said, yep, actually, I'm still here because I can hear someone outside and the smell still isn't gone yet. To which he replied, this is the stuff of legend. I said, the air is starting to solidify and if I don't leave now, I might never escape. and I said, made it. I'm now hiding in the kitchen, checking for fallout. Someone's gone inside. I can hear screaming. That was at 12:08. So there you go. So just remember, kids, colouring in foods can have a reaction. All right. Well, that was a thing. Shall we do a shitty superhero?
Yes, please.
Yes.
The heroes gone, we're left with all the nods. just want one Superman and not this bunch of slobs. Not a single one of them could take on Mr. Freeze. They're so lightweight they could get blown away in a stiff breeze. It's shitty heroes. The Spandex costumes are just a little bit too tight. They're not very cool and they're not very fast and they're most likely to die in a fight. It's shitty heroes. Just when look at these dudes and you know they ain't right. Marvel DC doesn't mean much to me because they are a total shite.
Hulk smash! Puny Lounge Singer.
Right, okay, so shitty superheroes for this week. Well, we've been away for 2 weeks, so I thought I'd come up with a good one, which is more sort of like to make up for the difference. So, we've got this one. It first appeared in Captain Marvel Adventures, number 22, in March 1943. The group, because there's a group of them, were created by a guy called Otto Binder and C.C. Beck. And I'll just read out what it says here in the wiki. The Monster Society of Evil were the very first supervillain team in comic books. They were a group of bad guys who clashed with Captain Marvel, not that one, and they first appeared in Captain Marvel Avengers in 1922 in March 1943. When Mr. Mind first came to Earth 2, he organized his team of evildoers, including Om, Mr. Who, Nyula, Ramus and the Dummy. It was only a prelude to one of the greatest evil teams ever assembled. Later, in Earth-S universe, he gathered the Monster Society of Evil. This included Goat Man, the Evil Eye, the Crocodile Men of Punkus, of Punkus. He also contacted leaders of the Axis powers and promised to help them win World War II, after which he intended to rule the world through Hitler, Mussolini and Japanese warlords. One of the three lieutenants was Nazi officer Herr Fool, spelt P-H-O-U-L.
At least he wasn't haircut, I suppose.
Not far off. He also gathered the greatest villains of Earth, including Captain Nazi of the Third Reich and Dr. Savannah. also in his team was Iback the Cursed. Originally a small-time crook with a big ambition, Stanley Stinky Print Whistle, Lucifer gave him, in return for his soul, the powers of Ivan the Terrible, Attila the Hun and Caligula. When he said the words spelled out their initials, Iback, he was changed into a green flame of pure evil. Nippo from the... Nippo from Nagasaki was a Japanese agent who used blackmail to force Japanese Americans to help him. A master swordsman and a martial art expert, it's unclear whether or not he survived the war after his battle with the Marvel family. He may have returned to his home by the time the second atomic bomb hit. Hold on, what's this? Oh dear, yeah, that's it, you found him.
Yep, I got him.
Mr. Banjo was a criminal who spied for the Nazis and sent the American military secrets to them in using musical codes. Guess what he used? A xylophone.
Oh, I was going to say.
Theremin?
Yeah, exactly. Now, Jeepers was an intelligent bat monster, the last of his cave-dwelling race. After all the members were jailed or dead, Mr. Mind was executed in the electric chair for 186,744 murders. Decades later, after the Marvels had emerged from suspended animation, Mr. Mind revived the core of the Monster Society of Evil, including Iback, Dr. Savannah, and the Savannah family, but the Marvel family nipped their plans in the bud. Finally, Mr. Mind assembled his greatest group of villains once again, including Savannah and Iback, but this time enlisted Mr. Atom, the atomic robot, King Kull, the beast man, and the last survivor of an ancient race who once enslaved an early man who was called Ogar, the world's mightiest immortal. Ogar attained immortality when he revolted against Shazam, who banished him and cursed him with cloven hooves instead of feet. The team went on to battle Marvel family in a number of other occasions. There you go. So we have basically Goatman, who is basically a goat.
He appeared on a very casual looking goat.
A rather casual looking goat.
Mm.
Yeah.
He appeared on a poster, and the poster slogan was, "We need you."
Oh, God.
Oh, I'm not doing it. I'm not pressing that button. I'm not pressing it. I kid. Oh, sorry. That was bad. Anyway, sorry. I'm not doing the yes. I'm not doing them. My favorite is Mr. Banjo. I mean, you know, what on earth was Mr. Banjo all about? I mean, have you seen the picture of him?
Yeah.
I mean, I can see him here.
Yeah, it's great, isn't it? It's like,
oh, he's the one with the banjo.
Yeah, it's a.
Did you mention Jasper's that he's showing on this rather wonderful double spread I saw?
Yeah, he's Jasper. I didn't mention Jasper here. I mean, I don't think. I like. Yeah, that's. I mean, when you see this lot, I don't know whether not to laugh or cry. I mean, the
thing is that there's 18 of these on this double page spread, and I'm honestly too overwhelmed to know where to start because they're all like garbage or garbage adjacent.
Yeah, Mr. Mind is actually some kind of weird slug with glasses.
For listeners, imagine a cross between the very hungry caterpillar and Harry Potter. That's what it looks like.
Yeah, and Mickey Rooney playing a Chinese man. I mean, what's it? The Goat Man is a cracker, and as for Crocodile Man and Captain Nazi, well, you know, what can we say?
I'm quite taken by Black Adam.
Yeah, Black Adam. Yeah.
He looks like a cross between Shazam and Dracula.
That's because he's the counterpart to Shazam.
And Ted Cruz.
Ted Cruz.
No, he's actually the chief villain for Shazam.
Yeah.
Yes.
Mm. But really, if you'd see this lot, you just laugh. I mean, especially Mr. Who. He looks like 1970s Rolf Harris has just escaped from jail.
Crossed with the hooded claw.
Exactly.
In fact, I'm fairly sure that outfit is the hooded claws and he's nicked it. Yeah. That's how evil he is.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. Well, there you go. Well,
I might have this as my desktop. It is amazing.
Yeah. So, what the fuck is that? What's Jeepers? That thing up the back? That just looks like someone started drawing a cow, then got bored and sort of drew a Mickey Mouse, and then got bored again, and then drew a, sort of like a Yeti from fucking Scooby-Doo.
That's Mr. Mind.
No. Jeepers. Mr. Mind is the thing that looks like a fucking brain slug from Futurama at the back with a pair of glasses.
Oh, right, sorry, I thought you were Black talking
Adam.
About that.
Yeah, yes, underneath yeah. Black Adam.
Sorry, on my print, I thought it said Jaspers.
No, Jeepers.
Jeepers marginally makes more sense.
Yeah, well, yeah. and King Cole, who looks like he should be featuring on the funny pages of The Sun circa 1975.
Jeepers looks like a mascot at the world's most depressing, terrifying amusement park. I guarantee that he is a registered sex offender.
Is it cross between Pedo Bear and something from Five Nights at Freddy's?
Exactly.
Oh my God.
It's like Euro Disney fell into disrepair and you suddenly find a costume hiding in the corner of a Baloo 50 years after it was put in storage. Wow. Well, there you go. Well, we have Mark Last to thank for that.
Mr. Mind at the very front bottom.
Front bottom?
Yeah, he's on the floor.
In the penis.
Oh, right. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, there he is.
Oh, yeah.
He looks like King Cole's going to step on him.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, not much for Mr. Mind. I like the fact that they have to blow him up in the background as some sort of ghost, as if he's controlling everything. I mean, you know, just in case you didn't know,
a force caterpillar. Mm. Mm.
And the less said about Nippo, the better. I think in this day and age,
that's a character straight out of Tintin, isn't it?
Yeah, that's a character. Yeah, don't worry. I'm sure it'll feature on some Facebook page at some point. Probably not a good one. But anyway, there you go. So thank you very much for that, Mark. That was a thing. That was the thing that happened.
So, well, it's quite spectacular. Mm. It's a gift that keeps on giving.
The more you look at it. Anyway, right. Well, we must move on. So thank you again for that. And if anybody else wants to send in any shitty superheroes, send them in to blackdog@geekplanetonline.com. And we'll sort of just mock them like we just did. That'd be great. So, Jim.
Yes.
It is time to open the Profanosauri.
It is indeed. One that's more appropriate than I realized when I got noted it down earlier this afternoon.
Brilliant. I'll roll the jingle.
Nuke the site from orbit. Euphemism. You know when you go into a public toilet, open the stall door and find the bowl wreathed in toilet paper, full of yellow water, with suspicious bobbing brown lumps, and yet somehow, seemingly, inexplicably, there seems to be more excreta on the walls and on the floor than actually in the bowl. That is nuking the site from orbit. See also Alimentary Gastric Review of Bay's Transformers and, new addition, Cameron's Legacy.
Nice. or yeah, Medcalf's Children's Cakes. Oh, otherwise known
as LV4-Poo-6.
Nice.
Yeah. Or if you got the Zika virus, the Olympic rings. Anyway. Right. Well, I guess we should move on. Thank you very much for that, Jim.
My pleasure.
Yeah, more appropriate than we ever thought. But yeah, let's move on. So I guess we should just get on and review this week's film, the 30th anniversary of Aliens.
There's a favorite film from my childhood. Loved it so much I watched it night and day. I never got tired of seeing the movie. But that was years ago, well I still feel the same. Blu-ray keeps on turning. Will my passion keep on burning? Rose-tinted spectacles.
Right, okay, so Aliens 30th anniversary. Yes, Aliens, directed by James Cameron, produced by Gale Ann Hurd, a screenplay by James Cameron, story by James Cameron, David Giler, and Walter Hill, based on characters created by Dan O'Bannon and Ron Shusett, starring Sigourney Weaver. Interestingly, actually says that's all it says on the wiki, Sigourney Weaver. She was the only one in it, apparently. Not Carrie Henn or you know, Michael Biehn or, you know, Bill Paxton or Jeanette.
That
Goldstein.
Bloke from My Two Dads.
Yeah, that bloke from My Two Dads. Yeah, Paul Reiser. None of those people apparently count in the Wikipedia of Aliens, but apparently, never mind.
Well, maybe it was just a good makeup artist and she played all the parts.
Yeah, maybe.
That's what it was.
Yeah. So, yes, so it was released on July 18th, 1986, which puts it about a week away from where we are right now. Running time, 137 minutes, except for the director's edition, where it suddenly comes in at 141 or 148 or something like that.
154,
that's it. Thank you very much, maths guy. Budget was $17 to $18 million. Anyone want to take a guess what it earned at the box office? Herc?
About 200 mil.
Okay. Darren?
I'd say, yeah, around about 250.
Okay. Jim?
150 million.
Okay. And Elton?
175.
Ooh, well, there you go. Elton's the winner this week. He got $183 million.
Ah, cool.
There you go. So well done. Yes, the David Giler declared back in 1979 that Brandywine Productions, the production company that made Alien, were intent on immediately making a sequel to Alien, having the full support of 20th Century Fox president Alan Ladd Jr. However, later that year, Ladd left amid Fox transition to new owners and new studio management, which had no interest in making a sequel. Giler accused President Norman Levy of being the one that held back the film's production, and Levy would later declare, "It was a movie I wanted to make, but he felt another Alien would prove too costly." In the meantime, David Giler, partnered with Walter Hill and Gordon Carroll, sued Fox regarding the disbursement of the Alien profits, and by the time the lawsuit was settled in 1983, Fox had new executives that got interested in continuing the Alien story. Giler pitched a project to one of the executives as a cross between Hill's Southern Comfort and The Magnificent Seven. While the producers were in development with Larry Wilson, they sought a writer for Alien 2, as it was known then. Wilson came across James Cameron's screenplay for The Terminator and passed the script to Giler, feeling that Cameron was apt for the job. Giler then approached Cameron, who was then in the pre-production of The Terminator. A fan of the original Alien, he was intent on crafting a sequel and entered a self-imposed seclusion to brainstorm the concept for Alien 2. After 4 days, Cameron produced an initial 45-page treatment, although Fox management were to put the film on hiatus as some disliked the pitch and they felt that Alien could not generate enough profit to warrant a sequel. As a scheduling conflict with actor Arnold Schwarzenegger caused the filming of The Terminator to be delayed by 9 months, as Schwarzenegger was filming Conan the Destroyer, which allowed Cameron additional time to write a script for Aliens. While filming The Terminator, Cameron wrote another 90 pages for Aliens, and although the script was not finished, Fox's new president, Larry Gordon, was impressed and told him that if The Terminator was a success, he'd be able to direct Aliens. Cameron even declared that he spent the production of The Terminator thinking about what elements of the film could make a real good dry run for the Alien sequel. Following the success of Terminator, Cameron and producer partner Gail Ann Hurd were given the approval to direct and produce the sequel and scheduled it for a 1986 release. Cameron was enticed by the opportunity to create a new world and opted to not follow the same formula as Alien, but create a worthy combat sequel focusing more on terror and less on horror. Sigourney Weaver, who played Ellen Ripley in Alien, had doubts about the project after meeting Cameron, she expressed interest in revisiting her character. And 20th Century Fox, however, refused to sign a contract with her over a payment dispute and asked Cameron to write a story that excluded Ripley from the narrative. He refused, however, on the grounds that Fox had indicated that Weaver had signed on when he began writing the script. And with Cameron's persistence, Fox signed the contract, and Weaver obtained a salary of $1 million, a sum 30 times what she was paid for the first film, and actually 1/18th of the budget of the first film. It's the equivalent of $2 million in present-day terms. Weaver nicknamed her role in Alien's sequel as Rambolina, referring to John Rambo in the Rambo series, and stated that she approached the role akin to the titular role in Henry V or women warriors in the Chinese classical literature. Cameron drew on inspiration of Aliens from the Vietnam War in a situation where a technologically superior force was mired in a hostile and foreign environment. Their training and technology were inappropriate for the specifics and can be seen as analogous to the inability of superior American firepower to conquer an unseen enemy in Vietnam, he said. A lot of firepower and very little wisdom, it wouldn't work. And the attitude of Space Marines was influenced also by a Vietnam War, and they were portrayed as cocky, confident of their inevitable victory. But when they find themselves facing less technologically advanced but more determined enemy, the outcome is not what they expect. Cameron also listed Robert A. Heinlein's novel Starship Troopers as a major influence on the that led to the incorporation of various themes and phrases such as drop and bug hunt, as well as the cargo loader exoskeletons. Aliens was filmed over 10 months with a budget of $18 million at Pinewood Studios, and Cameron was bound by a low budget and a deadline and found it difficult to adjust to what Bill Paxton called a really indentured working practices of British crew, such as the need for unionised tea breaks that brought productions to a halt. It was something that, George Lucas also found as well when making Star Wars. The crew were admirers of Ridley Scott, and many of them believed that Cameron was just too young and inexperienced to direct, despite Cameron's attempt to show them his previous film, The Terminator, which had not yet been released in the UK. They mocked the producer, Gail Ann Hurd, insisting she was only receiving a producer credit because she was married to Cameron. And Cameron clashed with the original director of photography, Mr. Dick Bush, when Bush started production in the schedule and said that it couldn't be met. And when he insisted on lighting Alien Nest really brightly, Cameron insisted on it dark and being foreboding, relying on the lights from the Marines' armour. After which, Bush was fired, and the crew then walked out. Hurd managed to coax the team back to work on the film, and Adrian Biddle was hired as Bush's replacement. Some scenes in the Alien Nest were shot in the decommissioned Acton Lane power station in Acton, and the crew thought it would be a perfect place to film because of its griddled walkways and numerous corridors, and had spent money to remove all the asbestos from the station. The atmosphere processor was not dismantled after filming and was in fact used in 1989 as the Axis Chemicals set for Batman. There you go. I'll skip a lot of the design, but it was done by Sid Mead, who'd worked on Blade Runner and Tron. And the dropship was designed based on an F-14 Phantom and an AH-1 Cobra. The British Airways were re-equipping some of its aircraft tug tractors, and the crew managed to grab a 635 HP Hunzit tug, which they repurposed into the armoured personnel carrier. It weighed 70 tons, and although the crew removed 35 tons of lead ballast, the power station floor had to be reinforced to support the weight of the actual APC. Yeah, the pulse rifles were based on Thompson SMG machine guns, and yeah, fine. Aside from the Alien Queen, which was designed by the Cameron himself, the aliens took inspiration from H.R. Giger's designs. The only change was removing the translucent dome that gave the creature's head a sleek shape in Alien, exposing a ridge spine beneath. Cameron felt the dome was too fragile for practical effects, and also felt the cranium design was more visually arresting without it. I'll skip over a lot of this because it's going to go on because I did it last time. But basically, a lot of the stuff was all model work, and which practical effects supervisor John Richardson won an Oscar for his film for the part in the film. And the Alien Queen was made full size and had 14 puppeteers to operate it, four of which were actually inside the model. The alien suits were basically black flexible lycra onesies with hoses just basically taped to them and a head stuck on top of the head of the actors. Dancers and gymnasts and stuntmen were hired to portray the aliens. Various mannequins were used, some of them 8 feet tall, which were used to stand in inhuman poses. And the face hugglers were fully articulated and could be moved by wires hidden in the scenery. And one that walks towards Ripley had a mechanism akin to a pull toy. So it's pulled along and moved its fingers, and the combination of three models was shot separately. The scene involving the Alien Queen was the most difficult to film. A life-size mock-up, obviously, was done by Stan Winston and crew. And basically, it stood 14 feet tall and also needed to be lifted by a crane to move around. Yeah, other than that, critical reception was generally positive. It's still got a massive rating on Rotten Tomatoes, 98%, and it still sits in Empire's 301 greatest films of all time and has an average score rating of 8.8 out of 10.
What about the shoes? Anything about those?
No, there's nothing about the shoes, not this time. Al Matthews, who was a sergeant, it was Sergeant Apone, actually turned out to be a first black Marine who was promoted to the rank of sergeant during his service in Vietnam. How about that? And this is my favourite fact. The alien screams, you know, that thing.
Yeah.
They're baboon shrieks.
Right.
There you go. And the last thing was the knife trick. You know the knife trick?
Yep.
That was done.
Yeah,
that was actually performed by Bill Paxton and Lance Henriksen, and adding Hudson's hand to the knife trick at the end was discussed by almost everyone except Bill Paxton, who, as you see, is actually giving a genuine reaction when it came to the filming.
One last fun fact: Al Matthews, who was Apone, reached number 16 in the UK singles chart with Fool in 1975. It's actually pretty good.
And he was also a DJ for the Soul Show on Capital Radio during the 1980s. There you go.
He was in Superman 2 as well, wasn't he?
Yep. Yeah, exactly. Michael Biehn got the call on Friday night before filming to ask to take over the role of Hicks as the person who was going to be in it. James Remar basically fell ill. What else? There's loads of stuff. I'm just not going to go through it all again. Oh, the word fuck is used 25 times in the film and 18 of them spoken by Hudson. There you go. So, there you go. There's lots of other stuff which I'll go through probably as I come up. But there you go. So, right, shall we go through this then? Because I'm sure we got tons of feedback and stuff and time will be marching on. So, who would like to go first?
Guest first is traditional, I believe.
Oh, that's true. Yeah. Absolutely. Thank you, Jim, for keeping me on point. So, so Mr. Herc, what are you thinking?
Okie dokie.
Go for it.
Okay, so first thing, I'm going to apologize to James Cameron for all the mean things I said about him because of Avatar, because all that stuff, you know, that wasn't his fault. That was people sharing it and me clicking it and all that bollocks, because he is an excellent filmmaker, man. He really, like, when he's got, like, control of the project, which is, like, essentially always, he knows exactly what he wants to do, and he does it really fucking well. Because I'm sure we'll probably do, like, a roundtable discussion on, like, the whole special edition versus theatrical cut, right?
At some point, yeah, depending on the time, but I guess, yeah, go on.
Yeah. But I actually found when I was watching it, even though I've seen this about, I can't count how many times, there were still like bits which actually took me by surprise. Like when Ripley and Newt are in the nest and it kind of, the camera cuts to show that they're standing amidst the eggs. Like even though I kind of knew that was coming, it took me by surprise.
Mm.
And then also the bit where the alien jumps onto the APC and kind of smashes its way through the windshield also kind of made me jump a bit, which is really like surprising for a film you must have seen at least 2 dozen times. Yeah. And it's just that it's so like, we'll come back to like the pacing thing when we discuss like different editions, but it is so well paced that it is very easy to get lost in it. And I did try really hard to kind of take the rose tinted specs off.
Mm-hmm.
And like, man, I've got nothing. Like, I can't find anything to criticize. Like,
yeah,
the only thing that bothers me is the blue tint. But, like, that wasn't, you know, color grading after that. That was the color that James Cameron wanted. And that was part of the reason that he fired the first lighting guy.
Mm.
But, you know, I can't blame the film for that, because that's, you know, 30 years of cinema just getting lazy and just going, oh, action film is going to be blue in it. What else? Like, oh, the other thing is, like, there's a lot of films which we like, you know, Ghostbusters and With Nan and I, which, you know, you think of as really quotable. But like for all the flack that James Cameron gets for kind of writing really simple scripts, this is one of the most preposterously quotable films of all time.
Yeah.
I guarantee you, you put up a single alien quote on Facebook and like within, what, 2 hours, there'll be like 50 different quotes there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Without a doubt.
And I think Paul Reiser makes a really great asshole who you just love to see just like get it.
Yeah.
And I know like all the Marines are like, you know, they're pretty lightly sketched, but they're all like quite likable anyway.
Mm.
And it doesn't do anything like super special, but I do admit like the Gorman and Vasquez's final moment, it's like it's really simple, it's really neat, but you know, it works really nicely actually.
Mm. You always were an asshole, Gorman. Click. Yes, sorry.
No problem. I honestly I can't find anything to criticize, and I do love the film. One last thing, which, because I'm sure I will say most of the same things that you guys will say, but the one thing that kind of stood out is, like, we all know James Horner's score is excellent, but the film also does a really good job of, like, knowing when to use silence.
Yeah.
Because that bit where they, you know, it cuts to them standing amidst the eggs, it's like there's either very, very little music or no music playing then, and it works really, really well.
It just got the Queen breathing.
Yeah. Yeah, I love that. It's interesting, by the way, you mentioned the score, because the score itself, because James Horner and was it James Cameron, had a bit of a falling out over the whole film, because basically Cameron couldn't give him a final cut, and Horner couldn't actually do any work to any, you know, he could do themes, but he couldn't do anything, he couldn't score to the movie, and so they had a bit of an issue, I think is the best way of saying it. They did end up working together later on with things like, you know, Titanic and what have you, and Avatar, but Aliens was a real strain on both of them because of that.
Well, he had like 2 weeks to do it, so he ends up like kind of recycling themes here and there from Wrath of Khan.
Yeah, exactly.
There's a lot of Wrath of Khan in this, score.
Yeah.
And I didn't actually notice that until fairly recently, so he got away with it. Well done.
Exactly. Well, okay. Well, I guess we'll just move on, and I guess everyone's just going to start pitching in at some point. So what about you, Elton? What did you think?
Okay, well, I took the specs off for this. This is a film, I know I said it at the end of last episode, but this is a film that I have caned and caned and caned when I was in my teenage years, when I was at school. There were weekends where I would watch it on the Saturday and then the Sunday and then not be bored by it at all. And like the Ghostbusters episode where I watched it and I found that that was the last time I really could enjoy watching it. This is getting close to it. I can feel it. But I still bloody enjoyed it. It's so good.
Yeah.
There are a couple of nitpicky things in it, but I'll get to them in a minute. But
okay.
You know, like the special effects still stand up, all the rear projection, all the animatronics they have, the way they've done it is all top notch. All the reverse shots that they used, like the gun into the mouth, eat this. That's all a reverse shot.
Yeah, that's right.
And the face hugger as it jumps towards the camera as well. The way they splice all that stuff up, it just works so well. Tension is almost perfect. The Marines sometimes they can ruin a movie. Look at Saving Private Ryan, where you just end up with Marines, but each one has a job to do. And once that job is done, then they are removed from the film.
Yeah.
It doesn't do it in this. They really build the characters. You really get to know them. You, not that you feel like one of the crew, but you're very close to it. And when you have a loss, when you lose the Sarge, you really do feel, oh, shit, he's gone.
Yeah.
You know, the head has been cut.
Well, it almost pulls the same trick as they did with Dallas in Alien, which is as soon as you feel like the person who's in charge disappears, you're kind of left directionless.
The only one who I thought came very close to ruining it was Hudson. It's almost played, overly played. He almost becomes a character. Couture of himself. He doesn't, but it's very, very close.
Yeah. And you know, I know we're not going to get in, well, we might get into it a bit more, but that's one of the reasons why I don't like the special edition, because you get more of Hudson being Hudson.
In the dropship
and doing, oh, we got the 45 Magnum over the head underneath. Yeah, we can blow you up and do this and do that. It's like, oh, shut up, you tit.
I actually love that speech because one of the weapons he lists is sharp sticks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but by that point, he's been going on for about 5 minutes, and I'm just, no, shut up, please.
Yeah.
But that's just
Yeah, the flow and build of the characters, flow and the build of the story as well, it's really well done. Even the stuff with the power loader, it's not just shoved in, you know, she jumps in a machine and moves it around and then you know you're going to get it later on in the finale.
Mm.
It's also mentioned earlier on at that, you know, it's Burke that comes in and says, oh yeah, I heard you've got your license. And it's dropped then. That's the first drop of it.
Yeah.
And so it doesn't feel ham-fisted and shoved in there just for a need to bring it up later on. It's really well crafted.
Yeah.
It is one of the best sequels ever for me.
Yeah.
It really is. But it expands on what went before. Like, it expands on the world in a very believable way. It's Alien is a very claustrophobic and beautiful film.
Mm.
But this expands on that. You don't get the claustrophobia. It broadens your horizon and gives you a different aspect of that world, like the industrial world that they are set in. So it's two different scales. It does it so well, though.
Yeah.
Some of the things I found a bit ropey. Guys in suits. Some of them, it looks really good. You know that bit, it's been mentioned before, with Gorman and Vasquez, and you got that alien crawling towards them with all the red light behind them.
Yeah, they kind of undercrank it, so it moves in a sort of weird way.
That just does it for me. That is fucking perfection. That is really good.
Mm.
But then 2 seconds before that, you got a fat man in a suit just bouncing around, and it doesn't look great at all.
No.
So they can do it really well, but then they also ruin it a little bit. Mm. The Queen doesn't look quite right. Looks a bit top-heavy. I know it's held up by a crane, and the way it's shot in camera looks really, really good. It just looks like the center of gravity's off, and it just doesn't work as well. I know we've all said before, the best Queen I've seen is in Alien versus Predator.
It is, sadly.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Mm.
But you can't take away that this is even though I've learnt to not really want the Queen, this is still a glorious animal that we got in front of us.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's fair enough. I mean, you know, as a first go, I mean, that Queen is so well realised. I mean, and it's what I always appreciate, even this time round, was how expressive it is. Without actually, it hasn't said a word, but you get the sense of exactly what it's doing and what it's thinking.
There is a shot that really does that, and it's with the power loader, and it turns its head further away from the camera, and the mouth and face tip backwards towards Ripley.
Yeah.
And it's as if I'm eyeing you up. I know exactly where you are. It's just such beautiful movement from it.
Yeah. Yeah. And what's really interesting with the Queen, and I'm not going into me, I'm not looking at wiki trivia anymore, but what I find really interesting with the Queen is that all through that sequence, it goes between full-size model, half-size rod puppet, and then down to stop motion at one point. And
with the power loader.
Yeah, and there's no seam, if you know what I mean.
Mm.
There doesn't seem, you know, where sometimes you can watch a stop motion, and because you get that sort of judder, you think, oh, that's the stop motion bit. Or, you know, when it's a puppet that's like half the size, the lighting doesn't seem quite right, and so it looks smaller.
Yeah.
And then, you know, but then you've got the Queen, which, you know, and I think they did a superb job of keeping everything looking consistent. So, you know, when you do see something that's fucking enormous, you think, wow. And then when you see it, like the bit when they fall down the well, the airlock, I mean, that's just dropping a fucking Action Man sized model down a hole. But
yeah,
you know, but when it grabs Ripley, just before it falls in the hole, that's a stop motion thing. And then just before that, when it's kind of when you see them sort of swinging around each other, one of them's like a 14-inch high rod puppet, and she's actually real life, and the rod puppet's being moved in front of the camera.
Huh.
And it's like, wow, you know, you're transitioning in sort of like styles actually in camera. Now, just I think some of that stuff that is some of the most amazing animatronics work I've ever seen.
Yeah.
But
no, it is superb. Yeah, I am close on not wanting to watch it for a long, long time now, though.
Yeah.
Which saddens me, and it kind of annoys me, but then again, younger me wanted it every single weekend, and
yeah
kind of ruined it for myself now. But flipping out, like you say, it is so quotable. Oh, it's... There are certain things to the story that I just didn't get in the very beginning. Where she's been floating around in 57 years, that's a dream sequence, and so can theoretically be classed as, is it really 57 years, or is it longer, or is it shorter?
I
won't go into the ins and outs of that. There's also when she's in the meeting and they're talking about the expense of this ship and what's happened, and the guys are really bitching on her about blowing this shit up, and yet it has been 57 years. And we all know nowadays executives will be sitting there going, well, I wasn't born when this happened, so I really don't have any right to bitch at you about this.
Yeah, but this is the corporation. This is the company. I mean, you know, we are talking about, you know, people who quite happily send a bunch of spaceships over to a planet to investigate something, to bring back a ship and basically declare all the crew expendable. You know, it's all about the profit.
Well, then they shouldn't really moan about, okay, it's all about the profit, but you're going to lose something at the same time. I just felt a little clunky for me, but it was only this watch that I'd really, really noticed it, because I was trying to really look at it from a different aspect.
Hmm.
Maybe you can kind of see that that meeting as like a fishing expedition, because the company in the first one, they kind of, I'm sure Ash kind of radioed or whatever, like there was a hint that there was something out there worth finding, right?
Mm.
So then that boardroom meeting is them going, well, what does she know? Which is, you know, why Burke's in there, and then Burke, you know. Actually, the question I had is like, well, I guess maybe it's just that they're a super powerful company, but it seemed weird to me that like a corporation could hire like a bunch of space marines, basically.
Yeah,
it was a little odd.
They were colonial marines, weren't they? They were. I always got the sense that they were to look after the colonies. So they drafted, you know, colonial marines. That was the whole point, wasn't it? So,
private police force, OCP, yeah. Anyone?
Yeah, exactly. So. Yeah, that doesn't bother me as much as one thing bothers me, but I know that someone's going to bring that up in the feedback, so I'm a little bit loath to bring up one point that really got me this time around. But anyway, so cool. Okay, well, what about you, Jim? What did you think this time around?
Well, this time I did put my finger on something that's niggled me with aliens for a long, long time.
Go
since
on.
I first saw it, and it was this time the penny dropped of what it was.
Go on.
It's always been a duff note, and it's just a little thing.
Go on.
It's the Marines.
Yep, go on.
Because my problem with them always is that they're basically assholes. And what struck me about this time was it was kind of,
mm-hmm.
When they're having that briefing in the front, they're all dicking about, giving you high fives, talking back. It's kind of, I'm sorry, if these guys were worth any salt at all as soldiers, and if a Pone was any kind of a sergeant, they'd be stood in a line and being bawled out for the minute they twitched or weren't paying attention. But instead, they're just fucking around like a bunch of frat boys.
Mm.
And this is the problem with, because I've always felt with aliens, another issue I've always had is the aliens themselves aren't very scary.
No.
They go down way too easy. They put up a good fight, don't get me wrong. And they are very effective in some scenes, but it's always disheartening when you see one just go bang shot.
Mm.
But one of the it struck me this time, they'd be more scary if the Marines were more competent. I mean, if these were like Black Ops, SAS, killing machines, when they start dying, that would have a massive impact and really put the oomph back in them.
Yeah. No.
And the problem is that you look at them going, these guys are going to get slaughtered right from the off. And it's kind of, I know Cameron said that's his intention, Vietnam War, blah, 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 but that is part of the problem. He's basing their characters on and I'll tell you exactly where he's stolen them from.
Yeah.
Apocalypse Now, the beleaguered platoon at the bridge, who are all just being left to their own devices and they're all just screwing around. Yeah. You know, it's kind of, who's in charge here? It ain't you. You know, that's what they are. And that's not the right type of soldier.
Mm.
It's like if you're doing a World War II, if you're doing a Vietnam movie, say, flip it around, and you went to that bridge at the Do Hong River and you found a full bunch of horse guards trooping the fucking colour, that wouldn't be right. You know what I mean? It's that kind of mismatch. And that really kind of, all the time, it sort of grated on me. I mean, since I first saw this, I mean, I played a lot of games both on tabletop and on computer.
Mm.
And when they first get to the colony and they go out, I thought I could have had half of them before they even got to that door because they're all too busy posing with those stupidly big guns doing the John Wayne, I just shat myself walk. I'd have had to wipe them out with a standard sidearm. You know what I mean? Never mind if I was an alien. You know what I mean? Gone.
Yeah.
I mean, the guns are cool, but the same that did strike me again, they're fucking impractical, aren't they?
Yeah.
These guys can't move for the damn thing. I mean, that's to an extent, that is nitpicking, but I do think it's little nitpicks like that for me that make Alien, it's a very good film, but the first one is a great film.
Yeah.
And this one, I feel there's just little things off notes in it that just hold it back from being a great film. I mean, another thing that struck me on this rewatch is how much, actually, it isn't innovating at all.
Yeah.
It's just reenacting Alien with toy soldiers. And it's kind of, you know, you get so far in. We have a chest burst scene. All right, it's a dream, but fair enough.
Yeah.
And then, you know what I mean? Everything it does has been done before. I mean, you can say, oh, yes, but this is the nest and the cocoons. And, yeah, but, you know. We've all seen the director's cut of Ridley Scott's film now, so we know that wasn't exactly it wasn't maybe the innovation we really thought it was.
Yeah.
What else? I think the film misses a beat as well. Burke, we don't see him die.
Mm.
Now, he's a slimy little shit, and according to my rules of movie making, he's the one you should see him die a really horrible, you know, Parker-style tug-in-the-head death. You know, I appreciate maybe the wanting to keep the, you know, the violence down, but for that character, you could have really gone to town and had an alien tail slashed off his head because, you know, he's a bad character. We want to see that. And just to sort of have him with the alien and, oh, cut away and just go get the money, that was annoying.
Yeah.
And that's always annoyed me. That's another thing I thought, damn it, yes, that's right. We should see him die horribly, but we don't.
He's in a deleted scene, though, isn't he?
Yeah, I was going to say, there is actually a deleted scene where where basically, you know when Ripley's gone down in to get Newt?
Mm.
And basically she finds location strap, yeah? And basically, and then she looks up. What she's looking up about in the is actually him going, kind of thing. And then she goes around the corner and finds him basically stuck in a wall. And she gives, because you also notice this, that when she pulls out the belt of grenades to throw it onto the queen, when she starts blowing up all the eggs, there's actually one of those grenades is already missing out of the bandolier. And what it is she gives one of the grenades to Burke. And walks away, and then he says something like, I can feel it moving, and she goes, it's more than you deserve, and gives him the grenade, and he just walks off, and then you just sort of, as she walks off, the whole thing goes up behind him, behind her. So, you know, it's, so he does get a, it's kind of interesting that they never really They never, in all the other shit that they put back in the director's cut, they never put that back in.
Well, they said they cut that because it made her seem cold. And in the director's cut, you're adding the stuff about Newt's family and her daughter. And it's like, you've humanized her and given her. So to add that, I don't know, it can work both ways.
Yeah.
But
it's one of those, I mean, I think this, yeah, I think this, you should have just seen him get, you know, a classic alien gore fest, blah, splattered, be splattering, you know? Yeah. That's the route that would have solved that anyway.
Yeah.
No, I don't know, that is more suffering, though, isn't it? Having him sort of like part of the brickwork.
Yeah.
it is, but it's also a steal from Mad Max.
Yeah.
That, you know, kind of... It's always a good one. I've seen it done several times since Mad Max, but, you know, at the same time... I'd have been happy just having his head pulled off, you know. I'm easily pleased. I'm not asking for the moon on a stick.
No, just his head.
Just his head on the stick.
No, just his.
Nice.
And as Hilton said, I did notice this time, kind of, some of the aliens do look a bit shoddy. There's one thing that struck me in the nest, where the alien, Ripley's confronting the queen, and then all her little helpers come out the woodwork. This one literally slouches around, "Oh, Mom, I was busy." And it just has that round-shouldered kind of like, oh, and he just wanders into the show like, fucking hell.
Still got a vag hanging out his mouth.
I mean, I know they built these to be white weight, but quite clearly they were still heavy suits, and that you can spot it in some scenes. And on contrary, on some of the other scenes, it's kind of, when they're coming down the ducts, I was reminded of those funny Facebook videos you see of dogs on wood floors. You know what I mean? It's just kind of skittering about, and it's kind of. Nice. I mean, you know, this is that is before the Jurassic Park embargo. We can have a go at the effects, but I feel it is ungallant to do so when a lot of them are as good. But I have to say, Cameron's design tweaks to the alien suit, I think, do lessen the creature.
Yeah,
and generally the way he plays them. I mean, I think just turning them essentially into a horde, and you dumb them down to being essentially xenomorph zombies. That's a misstep. But kind of just the way he tinkered with the look of them, they just kind of, he's missing sort of that kind of slimy biomechanical feel that the Giga alien has. And it's kind of, it's a little thing, but I really miss that translucent dome. And it's just kind of, it's that kind of feel almost over-designed, because you can see too many spikes and too many ridges sometimes.
Yeah.
And it's kind of, this isn't the same animal.
No.
I mean, I do think that the original alien, it could have just took out all those marines, all those colonists, all the other aliens, and that dumbass queen before you could say, it's a puppet! quite happily. Which is always going to be one of my big issues with aliens. But I appreciate, you know, you can't play the cat and mouse game again. You can't undo what has already been done.
Yeah.
And to go take it down the action route is a good move. And he does, I mean, he does cunningly, you know, I've watched this so many times. It's only this time where he thought, hang on, this is just really is just alien reconstructed. And just with the same beats, even to like the false ending of where can you think it's all over? Oh, it's not. And there's another confrontation and another final confrontation. It's like a fucking Yes song. It never ends. It's another build up. And I think it almost goes too far to the point of being, you know, you can go along for a ride and be like, oh, for Christ's sake, you know, knock it off, you know, get to the end. I mean, a few bits have dated. I mean, I think that blue sheen Herc talked about, it does have a very 80s look.
Yeah.
And it's kind of, I found that was a bit distancing. I mean, kind of, I mean, the shots of the Narcissus and the Sulaku, they looked amazing.
Yeah.
But a lot of the sets, they do just scream, I'm an 80s soundstage, in a way the sets in Alien don't. And I think that is down to how it's lit. And I mean, there's one, the ship with the scene where the drop ship crashes, and they're all stood in the just as we're going, oh no, and watching it crash.
Yeah.
I mean, with that obvious sky, the industrial shattered remains, bits of flame everywhere. That did look like every heavy metal video ever made in the last half of the 80s. I was expecting Bad News to step over a hill and go into Warriors of Genghis Khan.
Oh, from that scene, there is one nitpick I did have. Mm. You know the famous, they mostly come out at night, mostly bit?
Yeah.
It's always dark.
I think the thing is, there's a lot of little things in this that don't make sense. Mm. I mean, the thing about the weapons and the reactor core is just kind of like, oh, for fuck's sake, that's a bit shoehorned in.
Mm.
Yeah. And when he goes, right, let's have the magazines. Vasquez has got the biggest gun of the lot, despite being the smallest Marine, which makes her look ridiculous. Mm. But then she hands him the magazine, and the magazine is the size of a mobile phone. It's tiny.
Yeah, it's just a
you know what I mean? It's kind of, what have you done with these bullets? Well, you know,
yeah, I took that as the little TARDIS.
Yeah, he was going to say it's just the plug that runs between the ammo and the power supply. Oh, yeah.
But it's also the thing of kind of when they get to the nest, it's all looking Giga-esque and slimy. And it's kind of, well, actually, that look was the ship in the first one anyway. The aliens didn't do that on their own.
No.
They didn't just slather all over it. You know what I mean? And kind of, we're going to change the decor as well, some lay some eggs in here. And that's always like a bit kind of, it doesn't quite make sense, does it?
Mm.
It's also, what are these aliens going to do now they've eaten all the colonists anyway? Mm. That's another question.
Yeah.
It's only with the Queen laying more.
Yeah.
Then just, what?
Then you what? Know? Yeah. I mean,
do some more sculpture? Tea parties? I don't know. You know? I mean, get to the Alien Queen. I mean, I think kind of this is where the film does recoup a lot of my annoyances with the way the xenomorphs are portrayed. Particularly kind of people carp in the other sequels about bending the rules, but this is where the rot starts, I'm afraid. Mm. Acid blood, when we feel like it. How powerful is it? Well, not at all. Never. Mm-hmm. Very. Sometimes. Maybe. Do we need it? You know what I mean? It is just kind of, it's when the blood is as acidic as the plot needs it to be.
Yeah.
Which I always felt that is an annoyance.
Yeah, I was going to say, because that whole bit when they come through the ceiling and they start firing, I mean, that whole room should basically have been demolished by acid spraying in every conceivable direction after about a minute.
Yeah, they should drop down a level.
Yeah.
Should drop down 6 fucking levels.
Yeah, all the aliens just literally dropping through a hole left by the other 7 that they shot in the first place, just leaving a massive hole. Yeah.
Yeah. But, I mean, I think it does, pardon them, claw it back when you get the Alien Queen, which, apart from the scene where she detaches from the ovipositor, which reminds me of somebody getting up off the bog, the way it was shot, it was just kind of, that's not a flattering angle to show. And the way it connects to the body, I never really liked, I'll be honest. It was kind of, that doesn't feel right.
It's connected into the rib cage.
It's really weird and wrong, but not in a good Giga-esque way.
Mm.
Just in a kind of like, But, I mean, the Queen, as Elton said, I mean, it has such an, it's so well puppeted. And the different effects, as you say, it is really, really seamless. You can't tell which bit you're looking at. And for a film of this age, that's really going it some.
Yeah.
I'll forgive some slouchy teenaged aliens and some dogs on wooden floors skittering about here and there. Because, I mean, it makes for a superb final battle.
Yeah.
And, I mean, I noticed, as Elton did, where the kind of the power loader is seeded really early, but the way it is, it's worked into the universe.
Yeah.
So you don't realise it's a Chekhov's power loader.
Yeah, yeah,
that's
definitely.
Really, really well done. Mm. I mean, it's one of those things. It's kind of, as I say, I deliberately tried to watch this critically because I thought everyone's going to say, "Oh, it's brilliant! It's brilliant! It's brilliant!" And it's kind of, I really wanted to, you know, try and find are there flaws in it? And there are flaws in it, and it's still a great, you know, it's still a very good film, but it's just kind of, they just, let's say, there's duff notes here and there that stop it being a brilliant film, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it's kind of, if you wanted to be unkind, you can see the sort of their fingerprint, shall we say, flaws that will crop up again and again in Cameron's later work.
Yes. yeah. The gun fetishing and spell as well. That sort of, oh, look at this gun. Look at this gun. Oh, look at this gun.
Look, a chick with a gun. Isn't that hot? there's niche magazines for that. Don't tell me it's feminist. I'm not sure it is.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm not entirely convinced about that. No. but, you know, it's still a great watch. And when it's good, it is very, very good indeed. I mean, I think it has enough energy to, you know, to power along, even though actually when I think about it logically, there are some pacing problems. The fact that they really get rid of all the Marines in pretty much two fell swoops.
Yeah.
And I think you'd have an even bigger buildup of tension if you had a bit more, thinning them out a bit more kind of evenly.
Mm.
Better orchestrated deaths, shall we say, rather than just kind of, Christ, I've got a load of characters. Oh, fucking, just get rid of them.
Just spin the camera. Them. Just spin the camera around and have some shouting. Yeah.
But, you know, it's kind of, for me, Alien will still be the best. But, yeah. You know, as sequels go, Aliens, you know, makes a very, very good job of it and is a very, very worthy sequel.
Excellent. Right, okay, well, there you go. Darren, over to you, dude.
Okay, well, let's start with the scene in that film that affects me the most when I watch it.
Go on.
And that is Bishop in the pipe. Okay, every time I see him get inside that fucking pipe and crawl along, I'm literally crawling up inside myself because it's that whole enclosed space around him. There is not much room to move. And I imagine myself in that situation and I would go barking fucking mad. That's it. I would just lose it. I'd go 10 foot, let alone, I can't remember how far does he go. Is it like about a mile?
Is it something like 180 meters or something?
Yeah, I wouldn't go 180 centimeters without losing it. That's it. It's just very, very well done. Mm. It's just very well shot, you know, and all you hear is him breathing.
Yeah, exactly.
Especially for an android, the breathing thing. But, yeah.
Yeah, that's true.
It's very claustrophobic.
Mm.
And it just plays on me, you know, like nobody's business.
It was interesting that when we saw it at the Prince Charles, just as he did that, you could hear half the audience go, was quite funny to hear that.
It is, though. It's just very well done. It's not a long scene, but it's, and thank God for that. I don't know what I would have done. I'd be like, no, I need to fast forward through this bit. You know, I need to get through and watch the next part. Thank you very much. Let's have some action. Come on, let's show someone shooting something, even if it's in their own foot. Just something, for God's sake.
Yeah.
Go on, so yeah, very well done. I mean, the film in general is a great film. You know, it is one of those rare instances where a sequel is, you know, just as entertaining as the film that came before it. Mm. I think. You know, you don't get many of those.
No.
I think. No. You know, they can be quite rare.
They're like hen's teeth.
Yes, indeed. So I don't know what else I can say about it really that hasn't already been said. I do like the little dig at the way the US military kind of is portrayed, or you know, brings itself across of the gung-ho. You know, oh, we're so tough, man. And then when the shit finally hits the fan, hell, they fucking lose it.
Yeah, freak out at the first defeat kind of thing, yeah.
Exactly. I think that's a comment on the whole kind of mentality of America going to war. It's either the big win or nothing.
Yeah.
You know, which is, you know, going back to Vietnam, as has been mentioned before.
Yeah.
You know, if they don't get the big win, then morale really drops, even though what they may be doing is like fighting a really good battle and the steps that they may be actually taking, you know, there is another victory in there. mostly they don't see it.
Yeah.
You know?
Mm.
I'm trying to think of what else.
I do
keep thinking back to us at Alien War when I watch this.
Yeah.
Especially with the egg chamber.
Yeah.
As well.
Yeah.
Which is, I think we've discussed this already, haven't we?
Mm,
yeah. About on the cast.
Go on, go for it, go for it, go for it, go on.
It's that bit where Ripley and Newt are in the egg chamber. They actually had an egg chamber in the Alien War. I don't know, what can you call it, a ride? Can you call it a ride?
An experience.
That's it. The Alien War experience, which basically takes you through... for anybody who doesn't know, it was a form of entertainment where it puts you right in the middle of a base where fucking shit had just torn loose. Basically, the aliens get loose and these Marines have to get you from one side of the base to the other.
Mm.
And, you know, at the time, quite terrifying, but now thinking about some of the things that happened, like...
the guy getting taken out.
Yeah, I think it was when you were. I don't think you were aware that it was random, and so you ran ahead of everybody.
Yeah,
and ran all of a sudden, an alien leapt up in front of you, and as you're trying to backpedal backwards, suddenly you've got 15 people pushing you forward towards this bloke in an alien suit.
Yeah. That wasn't my proudest moment as I was pushing people.
It was funny though,
throwing people over my shoulder and saying, "Get the fuck out of my way!"
or the woman digging her nails into your leg when the alien appeared out of the wall.
Oh yeah, in the shuttlecraft. No, it was my arm. She literally
was it your arm?
Right through my forearm. She grabbed my forearm and she put a forefinger and thumb on the top and bottom of my wrist. And literally pinched, and it was like so painful. She drew blood, and I was like, ah, and she was just screaming, and I was literally dragging her by my bleeding wrist out of that bloody thing, and then then it's like, fuck you, lady, I'm out of here. Let the monster get you, I'm out of here. So much for chivalry.
Where the body count in this film is concerned, as in the people that get knocked off, you'll notice that, to me, it seems as though it's the least interesting Marines. The ones that don't get much kind of screen time at the beginning are the ones that pop off first.
Well, they might have been called fodder, cadaver, chopped liver. Exactly.
Red shirt.
Dead meat.
So I think we're left with the meat. By the end of it, especially, Hudson, that sort of thing. Great comedy value. And I do like it when that heroic last stand that he has, when he finally pulls it all together and just fucking goes for it.
Yeah.
You know?
Mm.
And his comments in general, like, we'll put her in charge.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, this little girl lasted much longer with no training and no weapons. Why don't you put her in charge? I mean it, Hudson. I've had enough of your bullshit.
So, in general, without trying to retread over the ground that's already gone before, it's still a great film.
Yeah.
I mean, I know we had a bit of a laugh at the audio.
Yeah.
When we watched it in the cinema.
Oh, that was bad. It was one of those moments where we kind of like, you romanticize going to see a film at the cinema for the first, again. And then you go to the cinema and then you realize that they're playing the original print. And there's like scratches all over the print. There's pops in the audio. And then finally, when you sort of got some of the James Horner score going, it's like the reel's not going fast enough, and he goes,
you could actually hear the audience laughing as well when that happened.
And there was even moments where it's like they're talking and then all of a sudden you hear, and then their voices go off and then the next scene comes on. It's like,
it's like one of those badly cut adverts that you used to get in cinemas,
Yeah.
Go to the Curry House on Mimsy Road.
It wasn't what I would say the proudest moment for a cinema watching at the Prince Charles, I'll be honest with you.
Yeah, indeed. I wonder if that would be like, I wonder if it'd be the same thing if somebody found an original print of Star Wars. Oh. Play, because you know how people keep going on about, oh, I want to see the original print, want to see the original print.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, play that and, you know, sort of the audio goes on it halfway through.
Yeah.
Oh, that would be brilliant.
I don't think I want to do that.
No.
Yeah. Anyway, anything else, sir?
In general, thumbs up.
Thumbs up. For me. Cool. Okay. Well, for me, this time around, I mean, I'm a bit like Elton. I watched this film to death. I mean, I really did back in the day. And I just could not get enough of it. I could quote it back to front. I could literally lip sync it along as I was watching it. And I am now at saturation point with it, I think. I enjoy it. I enjoyed watching it at the cinema. But funny enough, I switched on film 4 and they've been doing an Aliens series. So they did Alien, and then like last Friday they did Aliens, and then the other day they did Alien 3, then Alien 4, and then Prometheus. And I watched Aliens, and I sort of sat there long enough to work out it was the director's cut, and I was like, right, that's cool, I've seen enough, and flicked off. And so when I went to see it at Prince Charles, I'm sort of like, I think this is going to be like the last time I watch it for a few years.
Yeah.
And so I watched it. And I got to say, there's a few revelations to me this time. One, for all the hatred that she got over the years of being like a Jar Jar Binks style hatred, I have no problem with Newt now at all.
Well, neither have I.
I mean, she used to get, you know, as a character, I think it's, you know, just sort of like everyone doesn't like the twee little child. And I don't know if it's because I've become a dad or, you know, I've seen little girls running about getting scared and sort of trying to tell you stuff that's important. And now I sort of empathize with it as opposed to just sitting there going, oh, God, get a little girl off the screen. Oh, this is Jar Jar Binks.
But she provides a great little comedy moment in that film as well. Mm. When her and Ripley are in the medical bay and she's talking to her about a doll.
Yeah, yeah.
But she goes, no, that's just a doll.
Yeah, she doesn't have any bad dreams because she's just made of plastic. Yeah. And
also, when she puts on the military hat and says it's affirmative and does a little
salute,
that's genuinely great. Adorable. Mm.
Yeah, exactly. And that's the thing. I think it kind of, that to me was kind of a revelation because it was kind of like telling me how I changed as a film viewer. I wasn't looking for gore and blood and guts. I was looking more at like the subtext of the film now. It's like the motherhood thing, and you know, and the whole film is about motherhood. You know, it's like, you know, looking, you know, you've got the Marines who are like a family, you know, that are sticking together and how they get smashed apart. Then you got Ripley who you don't realize hasn't got a daughter, but you know, she's not had a child as far as you're concerned in the theatrical cut. She finds this child, she finds something, you know, becomes like a dysfunctional family with Hicks. And then you kind of get that whole thing mirrored again with the Queen looking after her family. You know, looking after her eggs and the family and all this sort of thing. And so that kind of thing, I really appreciated this time around. Really kind of dug that whole, you know, sort of like, this is Maternal Instinct, the movie. So for me, that was really, really cool. The things I also really appreciate were the effects, which still stand up. Though I have to say, the back projection was starting to look a little ropey. I think if they recolor graded it, it'll be fine. But there's bits when she's standing on the platform in the broken down atmosphere processor where it's very clear she's standing on a soundstage and someone's throwing tin tubes at her.
Yes.
While there's a big projection behind it. And it's like, yeah, there's definitely a lack of perspective there. They did as good as they could have done on the time. It's one of those things, that's almost one of those things now where you think, well, okay, if you're going to do a special edition, use your CG and change that shit. Because that sort of stuff is just like small tweaks as opposed to doing a George Lucas sticking a sort of Boba Fett walking across the screen and nodding. You know,
it's like when the dropship's coming in, there's like a little bit of a judder and some bad matting when it goes in the clouds, which you could tidy up no problem.
Yeah.
you know, and it's just I mean, considering the age of it, though, it still looks really good.
Oh, you get
even though it looks yeah. even when it looks bad.
Mm. I mean, don't get me
although
wrong.
Although, one thing I did forget to mention, the thing with the power center, there's all these arcs of blue electricity. Why? Because the 80s.
Yeah, exactly.
You can't do a film like this without random arcs of lightning on something for no reason.
Yeah, everything has to look like a Tesla coil.
It's such an 80s fingerprint now.
Yeah, yeah. James Cameron's lightning arc effect, yeah, sort of which you as previously seen in the Terminator materialization scene.
And Highlander as well.
Highlander, yeah, exactly. And so there was effects which obviously were dated and obviously didn't work, but like I say, the queen really made up for it. I thought this time round, I really sat there and just thought, right, okay, I know where the joints are. I've read enough books to know exactly where the joints are. Let me see the joints. And bizarrely, I sort of, the film just swept me back up again. I'm like, I'm not looking for the joints anymore. Just fucking punch the alien. Arr, get her. And that's a testament to the film. To the craft of that final 40 minutes is relentless. But what it does do is it made me really what's really interesting is it made me realize that for a film called Aliens, which is, you know, is more aliens, you don't see an awful lot of aliens until the last 40 minutes of a 2-hour 40 minute film. You don't actually see in the first scene when they all go into the atmosphere processor, how many do you actually see? You see one chest burster, you get the one that gets Dietrich that pulls her up from the wall, you get the one that gets shot that kills Crow with a spray of acid, and you get the one that has his head blown off by Hicks. Oh, and the one that goes through the window in the APC. So that's 5. But you never see any of the others. All you get is you get lots of cameras going around going, pff, pff, kill the shark!
There is that shot where once they burn the chest burster, they start to move.
Yeah,
and
but it's shadows in the fog. It's not actually creatures. You never see anything. You just hear.
Whoa. No. There is a shot where all you can see is tubes and legs and spines moving around.
Yeah, but what I'm trying to get at is the fact that you don't actually see a hell of a lot of these monsters. What they tend to be represented by is a lot of smoke, mirrors, and stuff shown on the trackers. You know what I mean?
Mm.
And it's really, and this time it really struck me that, you know, hold on, aren't there supposed to be like hundreds of them, thousands of them? You know, and then all of a sudden what you see is like 5. And it, you know, like I say, I know it's a minor nitpick, and to be quite honest, you know, take it as read that I love this film, okay? That's as simple as that. But this time round, I was so like, hang about. Well, where are they then? Where are all these fucking aliens? I mean, why aren't they? Why are they all hiding in the atmosphere processor if there are people about? And little things like that. And then on top of that, it was like when you see them all coming down. You know, when you start to see how many are getting killed off, you suddenly think, well, hold on, how many colonists are there? Oh, there's 140. Okay, so there's 140 colonists, presumably. One or two of them just got plain, you know, one of the two of the colonists got plain killed, you know, not cocooned. And on top of that, there's a couple of them that had the facehuggers removed that killed them. Then you've got Newt. So that, okay, let's say about 10. So now you're down to 130 colonists. And then you suddenly think, well, that means there can only be 130 aliens. And how many of the fuckers do they kill in that scene in the atmosphere processor and in the scene where they're coming through the walls and all that
probably
stuff?
Probably less than 20 total.
Really? Because I saw they basically waste the ammo of all of their guns. So, I mean...
that's the awesome thing, though, is it's taken you 30 years to notice there's not actually that many aliens in the film.
Yeah, no.
Well put together.
Absolutely. Again, you know, this is not don't get me wrong, this is not me saying that this film is shit. This is not me throwing it under the bus. This is me with so many viewings under my belt that watching it this time round, I enjoyed it, but I'm sitting there going, well, go on, is there actually stuff wrong with this film? Is there something I can pick holes in? Is there something which, you know, is a weak flaw? You know, because, I mean, as you know, we've got tons of feedback. There's no two ways about it. There's tons of feedback, and I can only apologize for anyone who wants to get to sleep. We may even have to break this into two parts. But the thing is, you've got to turn around and say, well, you can't just sit there and go, it's perfect, because it's not. Well, what's wrong with it? Okay, let's have a look then, you know. And like I say, you know, I kind of mirrored Jim's opinion that some of the Marines were so utterly full of themselves, which I know is part of the point, but by you know, but it does diminish the power of the aliens. It does make them cannon fodder. And this has always been my problem with this film from the start, was when you see the first alien, it's up against seven people, it wipes them out easily. But in this case, you think, well, if one of these aliens from the Cameron movie got on Earth, it would last about as close as it'd get through customs, and it'd get killed. Yeah, you know, it wouldn't get to Earth. You know, it literally get somewhere and they just go, right, fine, shoot it, boom.
Well, the thing for me is kind of, on one hand, he wants to try and keep them off camera and hint and suggest, but then when he does have them actually pop up, it's like fucking whack-a-mole. And that's the problem. I think it's the tactics that are wrong.
Yeah.
If you know what I mean. It's kind of, as I said, there should be a lot of these. They should be just, you know, really playing like cats and having a laugh.
Yeah.
But they just seem to be, the aliens look as disorganized as the Marines.
Yeah, yeah. There's one criticism which, I mean, I wasn't going to say it because I know from a discussion that someone else is going to bring it up. But there's things like who's in the fucking Sulaco? Who's flying that ship? I mean, are you telling me that everyone in the entire ship went down to the planet?
That's true.
Yeah,
I know who sent in that feedback. And I have an answer for that as well.
Well, I know who sent in that feedback because he confessed it to me afterwards. But I was already on that case. But it is a really odd thing when you realise it. It's kind of one of those once you think about it, you can't unthink it. It's like, hold on, that ship is bigger than the Nostromo easily. It's a big flying fucking gun, and you're telling me what? It's just an automated thing. It just gets shot off in a direction and then...
It's like the full complement of military force. Let's all go down to the planet. That'll be a safe and really, you know, a winning strategy if anything goes wrong.
Exactly. And not only that, none of them can fly the ship. None of them can pilot the Sulaco. So who is piloting the Sulaco?
Who says they can't?
Well, you never see them piloting the Sulaco. They're basically in the freezers. They wake up. They get in the dropship. They go down. They don't get involved in the ship at all.
Okay. Are we going to do this now? Or are we going to do this
We can do this now. I mean, if you want to wait for the feedback, that's fair enough. But like I say, we got 15 bits, so, and it's like coming up for like midnight. So I don't know quite how well everyone wants to sort of power through this, or if we do this as a second part. But I mean, as far as I'm concerned, that's one of those things where once you think about it, you go, oh, all right then. So from 57 years ago, there was a bunch of truckers who had better ideas of how to best handle their ship, you know, by basically sending three people off and leaving four back on the ship. You know, but yeah, I don't know. I mean, going back to what I thought of this film, I mean, I still think it's well made. I think that Cameron's got a really good eye for subtext when he's written it, if you know what I mean. When he's kind of involved and he has a theme and he has a plot and he has an idea, he can really carry that stuff across. What he can't do is he can't stop himself once he starts. He cannot he can't rein things in, and there's a couple of times where you think, okay, just okay, right, fine, just stop the military wankaroo, because there's a lot of this kind of, or everyone wandering around with the guns and sort of showing off a bit, and you're like, yeah, okay, we get it, can we just move on a little bit now? And you know, it's like you say, it's a minor nitpick, but you know, by the end, you don't feel that you've lost anyone when like half the crew disappear in a fucking, you know, botched job under
and a welter of found footage.
Yeah, and a welter of found footage, exactly. The other thing is also, I always wonder, basically, why isn't Newt drowned? Because the alien basically grabs her. is there a book?
Shut up, that's why.
Fair enough. But it's always something I've suddenly considered. It's like, well, the alien's not in any direction. They never see the alien leave with Newt. So obviously the alien went underwater with Newt. So, okay. Yeah. But anyway, apart from that, I will say that I do like the film. I think it's very well made. I think it's really enjoyable. It's infinitely quotable. The action, when it does kick off, is really well done. And I tell you what, Hicks is still one of the best, you know, sort of quiet heroes. And it's quite interesting that he doesn't really come to the fore until about midway through. You know, you kind of keep focusing on him, and you never really know why. You kind of get the feeling there's other Marines who are going to step up to the plate. And when he finally does, you think, well, there you go. There's the professional in the ranks. Because he's just, like, pretty casual about it. The only other thing I was going to say was, all these Marines say that they've seen aliens. And they seem to be a bit sort of blasé about it. And I'm, like, wondering, well, what is there out there then? I was kind of starting to wonder more about that, and why aren't they bothered by anything else, you know? But that's just me just going off on a tangent. But overall, very well done. And I the only thing that ruins it for me now, more than anything, is knowing that Alien 3 exists.
Can I ask something? Because I don't think anyone's brought it up.
Yeah, go for it.
When they're in the nest, basically, Ripley lets off the flamethrower as a threat of, like, I could do this to you, so, you know, back the fuck off.
Yeah.
And the Queen backs off, and then as Ripley's backing out, you see that, you know, stroppy teenager kind of making a move.
Yeah.
Is that... And I know there's no right answer to this, I'm just curious, like, what your interpretation of it is. Is that the alien queen kind of sending a message of, you know, fucking betray her, or is that like some rookie loose cannon?
Oh, the facehugger's a rookie loose cannon. No, because I got the feeling that the Queen triggered that. Because that goes back to that whole thing about the puppeteering. She literally just looks and sneers at the aliens, and they just back the fuck off. And then what happens is, as they back towards an egg, the Queen basically chancing her arm is one of the four that she's got, you know, and basically sort of sneers, and you see a sneer, and as you do that, you see the egg open, and it's like, I get the feeling that she triggers it, and that's why Ripley kind of sort of does that tilt, really?
Yeah.
You know, sort of thing. And it's kind of interesting, because that whole scene is kind of the pivotal scene for the entire film, and not just because it's just a good action moment, but it also... It's Ripley finally doing the sort of recovering from PTSD, you know, kind of letting her anger out on her, you know, playing her anger out on her fear. And there's also the whole motherhood thing comes to a head at that point. You know, it's literally laid out on a platter for you. Look, yeah. Queen's looking after her kids. Ripley's looking after her kids. Two families collide. One of them's going to, you know, maternal instinct fight sort of thing. And... you know, on top of that, it also shows a whole new angle to the aliens. I mean, the only thing I've always admired that scene and the Queen in that film. I don't like the Queen in terms of what it gives to the series, but I do in terms of what it does to that film.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
Because for me, that make, as soon as you explain the alien, it's pointless. It becomes just another thing. It becomes what, you know, Jim's saying, it becomes cannon fodder. And as soon as it becomes cannon fodder, you kind of diminish its power and it stops it being scary. As soon as you say it's an insect, as soon as you say it does this thing, you can suddenly prescribe action to it and go, okay, well, it's going to act like this. It's going to do this. They're going to do that. You can predict it. As soon as you can do something like that, a monster loses its power. As soon as you see a vampire, you go, okay, all I need is a bulb of garlic, some holy water, and a cross. Thanks very much, and good night. You are, and by the way, I'm not inviting you into my house, and just close the door.
That the queen makes it finite.
Yeah, but it also makes it predictable.
It turns them into animals, I think.
Yeah.
It's kind of, all the aliens just become dumb drones and expendable.
Yeah.
Whereas, you know, as Ash in the first movie says, you know, it's the ultimate survivor, the ultimate killing machine.
Mm.
These goons aren't.
No. These things, I mean, you know, the alien in the first film outthinks the entire crew and outmaneuvers them in every way. Whereas in Aliens, they just basically, it's just like, you know, I sent hundreds and hundreds of men to die on this field, you know, sort of thing. It's just like, you know, and then I won because I had the more numbers left standing. You know, that's its strategy. It's like constantly attack. I mean, whereas, you know, in the first film, the alien basically confused the shit out of the motion sensors by basically just moving in three dimensions. Whereas in this one, you know, it kind of does that with the room, you know, where they sort of go 7, 6, 5, that's inside the room. But it's a nice scene, but it's more of a nod rather than a showing what the monster can do.
It's a remix of the scene in Alien, isn't it? That's
exactly, exactly. It, you know, Ripley, I want to get the hell out of here because it's going, weep, 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 weep. He's close, Dallas, he's close, he's getting close, get out of there, and, you know, sort of thing. And it's actually, no, actually it's below you, Dallas. If you just stayed still, you'd have been fine. But, for me, that's the one thing that Aliens does to the series, which I don't appreciate, which is basically it changes the design and it adds too much explanation to the whole thing, and it's something that they then took and ran with in the other two movies, and I just think to the detriment of everything. But there you go. But whereas I like the director's cut of Alien, where it turns around and says, oh, there isn't actually an alien queen, we just turn our hosts into eggs, and you go, well, there's nothing like that in the real world, is there? And it's like, nope. Well, thanks very much for that. You know, it's another unknowable thing that this horrible thing's done. And how has it done it? Oh, God, I don't know. Oh, it just adds extra goo to the whole thing. Whereas this thing, it's like, oh, yes, they're going to grab you. They're going to take you. They're going to cocoon you. They're going to put a larvae in you. The queen's going to take care of you. It's going back to a nest. There's a nest. You know, as long as we're out of the way and we go back to this nest, bang, that's it. We've taken care of the lot. You know, we just pour boiling water down the hole. You know, done. Job done. Bit of rad away. But anyway. Okay, well, anyone got anything else to add before we move on?
No.
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 Nope.
Okie dokie. Well then, what we're going to do is we're going to go on to the feedback, but not in this cast. Oh no. What we're going to do is tomorrow, as of the time of this recording, we're going to record the feedback. We have about 15 pieces of feedback, which is, you know, fairly huge. And as we can tell right now, we're into like 2.5 hours and we haven't even got to the feedback. So what we're going to do is we're going to wrap it up now. And you can listen to the feedback as the part 2 to this cast, which will be released on Wednesday evening. So, it just leaves me to tell you, for those of you who don't go on to the feedback episode, what we will be doing next week. Well, next week, we are going to be doing the first of our Man Blub Month. Now, Man Blub Month, well, where did it come from? Well, again, it was one of those things where it came from me being stuck in a hotel on a business trip, texting Jim and Elton and Darren and saying, oh, have you got any suggestions? And as I slowly cleared out the mini bar in the hotel, basically coming round to this idea of, oh, wouldn't it be good if we just did? And this has come up. So this week coming, we will be doing the first of our Man Blood Month. And it's a suggestion from Jim. It is.
Mm-hmm.
Well, go on, Jim. I'll let you tell everyone.
It's the heartwarming classic from David Lynch, The Elephant Man.
Yes, indeed. The heartwarming classic. And interestingly, with an alien connection in the form of John Hurt. Of John Merrick. Wow. Yeah, this is all, we're already off to a flyer, I think, with Man Blood Month. So, who has seen this film? No, Darren's not here right now because he's had to just jump off because it's now like 10 past midnight. But what about...
He's turned back into a pumpkin.
Yeah, he has. He's gone into his narcoleptic fugue state. What about Elton? Have you seen this film before?
No, I haven't. No, I've seen clips of it on just TV review shows, but I've never actually sat down and watched it. So I'm looking forward to it.
Okie dokie. And Herc?
I saw bits on TV, but no, not really.
Right, okay. So you two are in for a treat. I saw this film once. Once. And yeah, I was quite young. I can't remember when this was released, but I do remember being quite young. And by the time it hit the end, I was a wreck. I was an absolute fucking mess. So I'm not really looking forward to this film at all, I'll be honest with you.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah. For those, also, we should let everyone know that if the subsequent films going on from Man Blood Month get too much, because we've got ones which are going to each press our buttons, because Jim's got his one, then it's Darren's one, then it's Elton's one, and then finally it's mine. We've all agreed that there is a wild card that we can press the button and basically not go through that horrible film. That horrible emotional experience. But the problem is that if we do press the wild card, we are all watching The Hottie and the Knotty. Okay, so just so everyone knows. So, there you go. So what about you, Jim? What do you think of this film?
I think I've seen it twice. I saw it on video. Mm. And I watched it again when it was on TV. And after that, I'm not watching it again. It's just too sad.
It is.
So I've only got myself to blame for suggesting it. I will say, for people who've not seen it, I mean, I said it's directed by David Lynch, but if you're expecting backwards talking dwarves and dream logic, forget it. This is David Lynch actually just telling a straightforward story.
Mm.
And I should point out, this is based on a true story as well.
Yeah.
And it is actually very historically accurate, as best as we knew when this film was made.
Yeah.
I think we know a bit more about the real life John Merrick now than we did when this film was made.
Yeah.
The fact is, actually, his name was Joseph, but because he had a speech impediment, everyone called him John.
Mm.
But, I mean, it's a superb performance from John Hurt. It's brilliant makeup. It is all shot in black and white, absolutely superbly. I believe it's Freddie Francis.
That's right. Yeah.
On cinematography, one of the great cinematographers, and Hammer Horror alumni. And considering this is a real life Victorian horror story, he's a perfect fit for the job, and it's just. It is a beautiful film, but it is very, very, very sad.
Mm. Yeah, it is. It is a proper stab in the feels. I think is probably the best way of putting it. It's like a harpoon shot straight through your heart. And I'll say this: if anybody wants to start turning around saying, "Oh yeah, I'm real metal and I've done this and I watched it, didn't cry once," well, bully for you. Bully for you.
I am glad that we recently had that thread up, which is the chicken soup for the Soul movies. I think I'll have two or three on standby after each of these.
I think you should. I think you should have Ghostbusters. I think you should have Die Hard. And I think you should have Wrath of Khan and possibly Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, all just on standby.
Yeah, Wrath of Khan, the end of that, it's a healthy kind of sadness.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's a healthy, upbeat kind of sadness, no. But, you know, films, yeah, you definitely have something on standby, like maybe a bucket of Citalopram. Just something, anything. So like I say, if you don't listen in to the feedback episode for Aliens, which will be released tomorrow... do send in feedback for next week's film, The Elephant Man. You send it into blackdog@geekplanetonline.com. And enjoy. So it just leaves me to say thank you to everyone. Thank you, Herc.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah. And gentlemen, my fellow hosts, would you like to tout your wares before we make a move? Jim?
Yes, you can hear me on my own show, Hypnagoria, every week. Episode that's just dropped is two short strange tales from the classic ghost story writer Algernon Blackwood. And the episode to drop this weekend is going to be a commentary track from a 1970s cult classic starring Warren Oates and Peter Fonda, Race with the Devil.
Oh, nice. Looking forward to that. And Elton?
You can catch me. I've just dropped an episode of the Grand Prix podcast with Andy Palastides. That was up on Sunday. And also on the Saturday, I dropped an episode of Shonky Lab with Lee Metcalf. And we're talking about 8-bit music. So please go get your dirty mitts on that.
Yeah, lovely. Yes, very good. Just don't fact check any of that stuff about the chips that I was talking about, because I looked some of them with that up on Wiki a little bit later on, and I was clearly wrong on a few points. But anyway,
but never matters. It never matters in the Shonky Lab.
No, to Google. Right, okay. And like I say, do listen to me and Andy and Pete on the Space Doc Jury, which you can find at spacedoc.geekplanetonline.com. And on iTunes, and join us on the Black Dog Facebook group, which is facebook.com/group/theblackdogpodcast. So, like I say, if we speak to you tomorrow with the feedback episode, that'll be great. And if we don't, we'll see you the following week for the Elephant Man. Yes, Man Blub Month. Yeah, and here's your chance, Jim. Do you want to push the button for the hottie and the naughty?
No.
Rightio.
I'm not that cruel.
Okay.
Oh, man, we're going to end up watching 3 sad movies and then The Hot Young Bunny.
You bet your ass you are. I'm not watching Babe again. I can't do it. Anyway. Right. Okay, so until next week or tomorrow, depending which episode you go for, we'll see you all again soon. Take care. Tatty bye.
Bye-bye.
Ta-da.
Oi.
No, I like it in here.